Well, that's probably where he'd like to pitch right-handed hitters, for the most part. But he couldn't get the outside corner down pat. And it's just like in a, like when you're bowling, you kind of move over. And what he did was he tried to throw a few pitches inside just to find the happy medium, which he never found. You know, and he happened to...
They can come back on you in the eighth and ninth inning. They've done it to us, and you know, we kept up with them a little bit during the course of September, and we noticed they come back on everybody. In the eighth and ninth inning, there seemed to be a different ball club, and that's the thing we're going to have to watch for. We get up on them and go into the eighth and ninth inning, we're really going to have to bear down and make a special effort to keep them from coming back.
You approach them any differently in the playoffs than you would in the regular season?
No, not at all. You know, it's the same game plan, in which I'll go back and look over the charts, and we have videos of the game that I pitched against them, and I'll just go back and for myself and look how I got them out and go right back to what I did the first time.
Do you see any different pressure on you as an individual? Do you prepare any differently mentally for a series like this?
No, not really. I know it's big. I know it's my first one, but I'm just enjoying it, and I'm just going to go out and have some fun at it. You know, how many guys can say when they're 21 they were in an American League Championship Series, and I'm just going to...
Live from Comiskey Park in Chicago, the Baltimore Orioles and the Chicago White Sox in Game 4 of the American League Championship Series.
Magic feeling, the magic Orioles. It's that magic feeling, the magic Orioles.
Orioles 83, brought to you by Budweiser Light. The best never comes easy. That's why there's nothing else like it. Nissan, builders of high-mileage, high-quality cars and trucks for 50 years. Available at your Datsun dealer. Ezrine Auto Centers and your local independent General Tire dealers. Coca-Cola, Coke is it. Crown, everything you want a gasoline station to be.
It's that magic feeling, the magic Oreos. It's that magic feeling, the magic Oreos. Magic feeling, magic feeling, that.
What a very pleasant good afternoon, and welcome once again. This afternoon from Comiskey Park in Chicago, it'll be Game 4 of the 1983 American League Championship Series between the Baltimore Orioles and the Chicago White Sox. Right at the very top, I'd like to tell you the weather has undergone a tremendous change in Chicago. The temperature today in the low 60s, the wind that was blowing straight out last night is blowing straight in this afternoon. And this is the ball game the Orioles have hoped that they would get into all year long, Brooks. They can win it all today.
Yes, they do. Yes, they can, Chuck. And I think they've got a pretty good shot at it. The White Sox ball club is down right now. And what it comes down to is how good Britt Burns pitches and how good Storm Davis pitches, because that's been the tale of these other ball games. It strictly has been the pitching.
Well, Britt Burns sat it out last night. He stayed home and watched the ball game on television. He wasn't in the ballpark. And one of the newspaper men in Chicago said, he's a lot smarter than we were. At least he could turn it off. But the White Sox were quite upset over some of the happenings in last night's ball game. The Orioles were, too. But they are outstanding professional teams. And that's history. It has no bearing on what will happen this afternoon.
I don't think so, either. You know, what happened last night, what it came down to, Dotson totally lost his composure. Kittle, same thing. After the inning was over, or after the things took over, well, it was just play baseball. But otherwise, I look for a game today, Chuck, with Britt Burns, who's been in and out most of the year. He's 10-11. Storm Davis has had a pretty good year. He's had some arm problems. Ray Miller went to the bullpen with him today. He wanted to see him warm up. And what they want from Storm Davis is 5 or 6 strong innings. And I think the key to it in the bullpen, Ray Miller was going to look at his face and see if he had any tinge of arm problems, or did it show on his face, the expression, when he went to warm up. So I think that was the key. He's back. He's going to start the ball game.
And speaking of injuries, just a word about the Chicago White Sox outfielder Ron Kittle. The pitch that hit him on the knee, and as you all know, the next day it's by far worse than it was last night, and it really is puffed up. They're going to drain the knee, and then they'll take x-rays, and let's all of us hope that it's going to turn out to be nothing but a very severe bruise that the fine young White Sox outfielder can shake off. But it did trigger some rather unpleasant moments in last night's ball game. But as I said, that's out of the way. Burns is a power pitcher.
Yes, he is. He's been in and out most of the year. He had some personal problems during the year. He had some arm problems. He's almost an unknown quantity this year. The Orioles have only faced him for one inning this year. But he's a guy who has learned to pitch. He doesn't rely on the overpowering fastball anymore. He changes speeds. So, you know, here is someone who has pitched extremely well the last month of the season. Burns got about three or four starts and did well. So it ought to be a great ball game. And I think these fans, the White Sox fans, are going to be into it. It took the Oreo fans a game to get into it, and they sound like they're really ready to go.
Well, as a matter of fact, many of the White Sox ballplayers felt that the Oreo fans in Baltimore helped the ball club tremendously. They felt they had perhaps got into the game a little bit more than the White Sox fans did, and they said so publicly here in Chicago, and the result is what you hear behind us this Saturday afternoon at Comiskey. The White Sox fans are really in it. They're backed into a corner. There is no tomorrow. It all rests on Britt Burns, and for the Orioles, it rests on Storm Davis, but for the Orioles, there is a tomorrow, and if it had to be, that game would be pitched by Scott McGregor. Davis's condition physically, Brooks, has nothing to do with the throwing arm. It's behind the left shoulder.
Yes, it's behind the left shoulder. And talking to Ray before the ball game, the thing he impressed on me is he wanted to see Storm warm up himself, and that usually does not happen. Elrod is in the bullpen taking warming up the pitcher, but this particular time Miller went to the bullpen with him and just wants to see. Usually, if someone's hurting, you can tell it in their face before any place else. And he just wanted to see the expression on Storm's face warming up.
Well, a lot of the talk about the Baltimore Orioles and Chicago White Sox in Chicago today is that these two ball clubs really do not like each other. I know that they respect each other tremendously, but there's been a lot in the print here in Chicago today about the fact that they just flat out do not like each other. And there have been some little things that have happened that have created rather unpleasant situations. One of those occurred in Baltimore when Oriole infielder Todd Cruz went across the field during the workout day to visit with some of his friends in the Chicago dugout and lost his glove, and that glove has not yet been returned. Now, that's a game glove, and that's on a par with a game bat, right?
That's very true, and I know Todd especially, he relies on his defense more than anything else, and to lose a game glove, it would be like me losing one. I would tell you, I would be strictly upset, because most of the time, you have a glove you use in the game, and you have two or three that you're breaking in. But I know Todd was a little upset, because he knows some of the players on this ball club, and he was disappointed that someone would steal his glove to play a trick on him. But it has not showed up, it has not been returned, and he is disappointed.
It is really not a very professional attitude, actually. And one of the other comments came from a fellow you all know and like a lot, Rick Dempsey. Dempsey kind of said it for everybody, Brooks, when I think he said, hey, look, I don't ever want to hear that Shane on now again.
Well,
he didn't want any parts of goodbye.
Well, it was a very quiet crowd last night. And when you, when Eddie Murray jumps on a pitch in the first inning and hits a three-run homer, that will make everyone be a little more subdued. But, no one can tell what's going to happen today, Chuck. Britt Burns could go out there and be sensational. Storm Davis could go out and be sensational. But I will say one thing. This ball club, the White Sox, are down a little, and this is the time to do it if the Orioles are going to do it.
Well, I think the Orioles started to turn things around in the last three innings of the very first game, and now they're beginning to play their game, and we'll be back with more right after this message. Well, let's give you a rundown on the Oriole batting order as they come out against the hard-throwing Britt Burns. It'll be John Shelby leading off. He'll be in center field, of course. Number two batter, right fielder Tito Landrum. Number three, it'll be Cal Ripken, the Oriole shortstop, in the number four position. First baseman Eddie Murray. Batting five, left fielder Gary Renicky. Number six hitter, the Oriole designated hitter Ken Singleton. Batting seven at second base, Rich Dower. The number eight hitter, the third baseman Todd Cruz. Batting nine and catching is Rick Dempsey. And for the homestanding Chicago White Sox, when they come on against Storm Davis, it'll be Rudy Law leading off center field. Carlton Fisk, number two batter and catcher. Hitting in the number three spot against Storm Davis will be Harold Baines. He'll play in right field. Number four batter is Greg Lozinski, the designated hitter. Batting number five and playing in left field is going to be Tom Pachorik. Tom Pachorik will bat number five, and he will be the left fielder. And for the White Sox at first base this afternoon, Greg Walker in the number seven position. At third base, Vance Law. Batting eight and playing shortstop today for Chicago, Jerry Dibzinski. And the number nine hitter will be the Pale Hose second baseman, Julio Cruz. The umpires at the plate on balls and strikes, Jim Evans. At first base, Dave Phillips. Second base, Mike Riley. Third base, Jim McKean. Left field line, Durwood Merrill. Right field line will be Nick Bremigan. This telecast is broadcast under rights purchased by WMAR-TV. From Baltimore Baseball Incorporated, it is intended solely for the private use of our viewers. Any rebroadcast or other transmission of the description of the game without the express written consent of WMAR-TV is strictly prohibited.
Well, it's Britt Burns for the White Sox, 11-10 on the year. 24-year-old left-hander started the season on the disabled list with a viral infection in his pitching arm. He was activated May the 9th, but was bothered by some personal problems that led to a short stint in the bullpen. When he returned to the starting rotation, he had a great game against the Yankees. And at the last part of the year, he pitched a one-hitter against the California Angels. He threw a two-hitter on a 2-0 victory over the Angels again. And a lifetime against the Orioles, he's 3-2. Power pitcher, breaking ball, changeup. And this is John Shelby leading off.
And the first pitch from the Britt Burns is a ball one, and here we go in game four. Burns, as Brooks mentioned, has not had a decision against the Orioles this year. He won two against Baltimore last year without a defeat. Career-wise against Baltimore, Burns has won three and lost two. And he's behind the hitter, two balls and no strikes. John Shelby has had one hit in four trips in the three games to date. And the 2-0 to the waiting Shelby. Crowd kind of late arriving. Number one, they didn't have a heck of a lot of sleep last night. And when you have championship games and big crowds, the traffic buildup around the ballpark here is just as it is back in Baltimore. And that will make the count three balls and two strikes.
You'll see a picture of Ron Kittle. This is the day after the introductions. He has to have some crutches to get around on, and took a fastball right on the kneecap.
Ooh, boy, that's a miserable foul ball.
It's ballpark, 341 feet, right down the left field line, 374 in left center, right center, 401 to dead center, and they have a swirling wind. I look around at the flags, and every set of them are blowing in different directions.
Yeah. Two balls, two strikes. I think I said 3-2. 2-2 the count to Shelby. Now it's 3-2 up on the board. I thought it was, and they just changed the count. Okay. Now here comes your third baseman. He's got to hurry that throw. No way.
Yes, sir.
John Law Shelby had a little trouble getting rid of the ball, Brooks, and Shelby's speed allows him the infield hit.
Law playing very deep on John Shelby. The ball is hit. Here you'll see him. The ball over the third base bag. Law's got it. Now he takes a little crow hop, throws, but Shelby beats it out for a base hit.
That'll bring out Tito Landrum. Now, Landrum has been to the plate five times in the series without a base hit.
Burns, a very average move to first base. Does not get off the mound that great.
Shelby has stolen one base in the playoff series, and during the regular season, he stole 15.
Chuck, looking back last night on that ball game, it surprised me and just about everybody in this ballpark that the White Sox did not try to make Flanagan get off the mound.
Right.
The only time that he did get off the mound, he was a little slow getting over on a ball that Vance Law hit and was not able to make the play. But it just does not make much sense to me. It's not that they didn't know about it. I mean, here's a guy who's got a brace on his knee and has some problems getting off the mound, but the White Sox did not exploit it.
And let's see what Landrum and the Orioles might be doing. Burns has gone over there three times now without coming to the plate.
Well, this is a good duo. A lot of things can happen here. Shelby can steal a base. Tito can put the hit and run on.
Well, we wondered whether or not they were going to bunt, and Landrum certainly gave indication of the bunt, taking strike one.
I don't think it's a bad little play. Get him over right now.
Anytime you can get out in front, you get there. And if you can do it in the first inning, it is most helpful. And they're trying to... Some people say that bunting is playing for one run, but...
Well, you got Ripken, you got Murray, the best 1-2 punch in baseball coming up behind you. I'd like to see a runner at second base.
That was a... Speaking of runners, the fact that Eddie Murray stole the base last night made manager La Russa unhappy. He thought with a big lead, there was no point in his stealing. When they determine how many runs you need to win a ball game, then we can figure out whether you should steal or not. Well, he pulled the bat back this time, and that'll even the count of one ball and one strike, and they've been just, the bunting game is on right now. Let's see whether it's still on. As you take a look at John Shelby, who was eyeing Cal Ripken.
Britt Burns had four shutouts during the season, and that's right at the top of the list. He can be overpowering. Pitched well the last month and a half of the season.
A cold, raw day, windy and cold in Chicago this Saturday afternoon. And they look like they're staying with a bunt on every pitch that's come to the plate. On the count now, two balls, one strike.
Well, it's not a bad idea to stay with the bunt because, as we said before, Burns is not going to bounce off the mound that well. Greg Walker at first base, a very average infielder, first baseman.
Bounded right back to Burns. They get him at second base without any trouble. The bunt was just a very poor bunt. Landrum bunted it not only too hard, but he bunted it right back at the mound. And Shelby is forced. Anyway, a little bit to the first base side or a bit to the third base side. And
well, that's where he was going. He was going towards first base, but it bounced right back to Burns, who made a nice, easy throw to second base and plenty of time to get Shelby.
Here now, Cal Ripken. And Ripken having another outstanding series. He's had so many of them this year. Hitting .417. 12 trips to the plate with 5 hits. 2 doubles and a run batted in.
If you had to pick an MVP of this series so far, it'd be up in the air.
I'll tell you, it'd be kind of tough to pick, wouldn't
sure
it?
Sure would. The MVP is going to make his presence known today or tomorrow. And the winner will get a new automobile.
Ball one. Now, this is not at all unusual for Britt Burns. He's the kind of a fellow that can work this way. He'll be behind quite a few hitters. Picks up the strike.
When Burns has his control, that helps him with all the other pitches, too. That means if he's got the fastball, getting the fastball over consistently, that's when he can start changing speeds, changing up on his fastball a little. But when you can't get that fastball over, it's tough to get the rest of your pitches in the groove. Breaking ball.
And the 1-2. Right by the pitcher. He got a good hop off the mound. They'll turn the double play. Whiffed. He did it. Did he get him? Yes, he did. He tagged up again. And the double play is turned. At the end of the first half inning of play, the Orioles nothing and the White Sox are coming to bat. Well, Storm Davis on the mound, and we've been telling you a little bit about the weather conditions. Kind of cool and windy. Storm Davis is out there without any kind of an undershirt at all. He is ready. And Storm on the year had just a brilliant season for the Orioles. Made 29 starts, 6 complete games, 201 third innings to an earned run of about 3.5. Walked 64, struck out 125.
That led the Orioles staff in strikeouts, too.
On the road, Storm Davis was just almost unbeatable. He was 11-2 with an earned run of 3.81 in 18 games, making 15 starts on the road this season. His only away losses, one of them came in Minnesota on the 31st of May, and in Boston on September the 15th. He is just 2 wins, 5 losses in 16 appearances, covering 14 starts at home. But he had a better ERA at home, 3.34. Well, lifetime record in the other guy's ballpark then is 14 wins and 4 losses.
We mentioned yesterday, Chuck, in the opening that I think all these players find it a little easier to, not a little easier, but a little less pressure when you play on the road. They don't mind coming to the opposing ballpark because, you know what the crowd reaction is going to be, but I think there's less distractions when you're on the road. You think about baseball a little more than you would at home.
Here's the double play. Dobzinski got a nifty kind of a hop off the mound. That ball hit the front slope of the mound and kicked right to the left toward Jerry, and Jerry made the pickup. His throw to first was kind of off the money, but Greg Walker was able to get to the bag in time to complete the double play. Here's Rudy Law.
Well, the scouting report on Rudy Law before this series started was keep him off base if you didn't want trouble. Well, the fact is that he's been on base just about every time in this series, and it really hasn't hurt us as much as I thought it was going to be.
He's 7 for 13, Brooks, and that's a whale of a series.
Stole 77 bases this year. And there was a lot of talk even before this series started that they might try to get a little more right-handed punch in the lineup when you had a left-hander, but they decided to go with the defense and Rudy Law, and it was the best thing that happened to him.
2-0 now to Rudy. Storm Davis won the American League's Eastern Division clinching game for the Orioles against Milwaukee, and now picks up the strike. And he'd love to repeat that happening this afternoon. Clincher came September the 25th at Milwaukee. And that was the first outing for Storm in some 10 days. 2-1 pitch to Law. Tough play, but Dower knocks it down and then makes the throw in time to get Rudy.
Well, if you would have seen the plays that we, the Orioles, made last night, you can appreciate it. Dower made just an outstanding play right at that particular time. He knocks his line drying down, smothers it, keeps it in front of him, is able to throw the speedy Law out at first base.
Tell you, Law hit the ball last night, hit it as hard as you can hit it, and Dower turned it into a double play. Well, here's Carlton Fisk. And on the playoff series, he's hitting 167, been up 12 times with two base hits. No score, bottom of the first inning. Overcast, breezy and cool in Chicago this afternoon. And I looked around, Brooks, I agree. You said it just exactly the right way. You look at the pennants on the roof, and you look down the right field side. They're blowing from the left field corner to the right field corner. You look out in center field, they appear to be blowing in.
I know last night the Orioles had some real problems with the pop-ups. It's like when the ball goes up, the player goes after it. As soon as the ball gets above the roof, though, it's like Chris Everett takes her racket and whacks it right back towards the field. And we overran a couple of pop-ups last night, did not come up with them. Oriole Ball Club hitting 202 in this series so far, and the Chicago White Sox Ball Club 189. And the fact is that Oriole pitchers have outpitched the White Sox pitching staff.
Well, I think one of the comments that you made in our very first game, Brooks, you said if the Orioles are going to win this playoff series against the White Sox, they're going to have to make a dent in Chicago's starting pitching. They have done that.
Yes, they have.
Dower tries a throw, couldn't get him. What an exceptional effort from Dower. And Fisk, not really a bad runner for a man his size. Dower gets to the ground ball, but after he got there, there wasn't very much he could do. And this is something that you'll notice when Storm Davis pitches. There are a lot of balls hit right back through the middle.
Great
and
effort.
He is really not a very good fielding pitcher.
Well, he's not in a position to catch the ball, but certainly he's not going to change his style of pitching just to drop a ball
Absolutely.
Up the middle. And Dower made a great effort that particular time. Fisk in that situation, it looked like he was trying to go that way, trying to go the other way, and he just hit the ball up the middle in a good spot. Now you got Harold Baines.
And Harold is 0 for the series, and he can break out of it any time at all. This is just too good a hitter to go 0 for any prolonged period of time.
Well, he hit the ball on the nose three times last night and had to go back to the dugout. But he is looking for his first hit in this series, 0 for 12.
One ball, one strike to Harold Baines.
I thought last night he was a little more under control than he has been the first few ball games. He was very anxious, swinging a lot of balls out of the strike zone. Last night, he looked like he had it all together.
Two balls, a strike. balls, a strike. And you notice that Davis against Baines, as you see the on-deck hitter Lozinski, has been moving the ball around. He's been up and away, down and away, low and inside, and has just been a little bit out of the strike zone.
Not missing by much. You're exactly right.
They may get him.
Well, that's just not good play.
That's exactly right. They did get him.
They did get him, and as I said, that's there's no way he should be double off on that ball.
Well, that's another mistake. The little things that beat you at the end of one inning. Baltimore nothing, Chicago nothing. Well, again this afternoon, if an Oriole hits a home run during the Equitable Bank home run sweepstakes inning, some lucky fan's going to win a lot of money. It'd be $1,800 today, and I hope everybody realizes if it happens to be a home run with the bases loaded, then the money is $1 million. Details are available at any Equitable office, and the contestants have been selected at random from users of Response, Equitable's 24-hour automatic teller, or from postcards sent to Equitable Bank Home Run Sweepstakes. If your name is drawn, you're 18 years or older, you can be a winner. Eddie Murray against Britt Burns in the top of the second inning, game four. The Orioles with a 2-1 edge in games and would love to be able to come home to Baltimore tonight. Mr. Burns threw that about as hard as he's thrown anything this afternoon.
Murray 1-for-10, but it was a big blow. It set the tone of last Nats game. Upper deck, right field.
Scored a few runs, too, did Eddie. Drove in three, scored four, walked three times. One ball, one strike. Here are the slugging percentage leaders, Brett, Rice, Murray, and Fisk. And the 1-1 to Eddie. Left fielder won't get to it. Murray has another postseason base hit. That'll bring out Gary Renicky. And to say that Renicky has had a good playoff series would be an understatement. He's hitting absolutely 1,000. Been to the plate two times with two base hits. Four runs. He has a double. He has a home run. He has three runs knocked in.
This looks like a breaking ball that Murray hits here. Slider something down, but he's on it. Drills at the left field. And you're right about Gary Renicky. Even during the season, he had four home runs and 12 RBIs against the White Sox, which was a big gun against them. Did not hit for the high average, but every hit that he got meant something. And by his own admission, he said the other night, in his 6 years of pro ball, that was the most exciting and best game that he's ever had.
And the count now 2-0.
Now, this is not the position you like to get yourself in against Renicky. This is the same situation that when he hit the home run, he had two balls, no strikes. Bannister left a fastball, or he said it was a breaking pitch. Well, to me, it looked like a fastball the other night, out over the plate and up a little.
And of course, he's knocked in a run. So he's got kind of a sore foot. Talked to him in the hotel this morning. He said, "Don't worry about it. I'm playing." First and second. That's out of play, and nobody out. Well, not all, but many of those vacant seats that we saw a little while ago are beginning to fill up now. As I guess it'll be like in the third inning before everybody gets here, but it's a raw, cold, windy afternoon in Chicago. Britt Burns in his 27th start of the year, and his one ball, one strike. Burns is one of those fellas that's kind of like that girl with a curl in the middle of her forehead. When she was good, she was very good, and when she was bad, she was horrid. And he's that way. He's had four shutouts. And there have been other times when he really didn't want to talk much about it, and I wouldn't blame him.
He can be one of the top two or three left-handers in this American League. There is no doubt about it. They have been predicting stardom for Burns for the last few years, and he's had a couple of big years.
Tell you another thing. This is a man that is not at all afraid to get in your kitchen. He is not afraid to pitch inside. Now the 1-2 to Singleton. 2-2. That umpire down there is Dave Phillips. Lowry, the lead runner at second. Reneke at first base. Nobody out. We're in the top of the second inning. And the pitchers off to a fair start. They haven't been overpowering like a Mike Boddicker or a Lamar Hoyt, but certainly off to a reasonably good start. The 2-2 pitch to Singleton. Went the fastball and just blew it right by him. And Brooks, we're a long way from home plate, and you're a much better judge than I, but it looks as though Burns has really got a good fastball. He's throwing awfully hard.
Well, when you throw it up there, it's even faster, Chuck, and you're right. He threw it right by Singleton. That's always been his bread and butter pitch, but he has come up with a few little off-speed pitches that have helped him considerably.
Now Rich Dower. Dower looking for a base knock in the playoff series. Richie's gone up to the plate a total of 10 times, and he's 0 for 10. And you see the little conversation as to whether or not he's in or out of the box.
Dower has been the star defensively today. Wouldn't it be nice for him to be offensive star? Looking for his first base hit in this series, 0 for 10.
Out of play. Tell you, if I had a guy who was 0 for 10 in the series, I wouldn't worry about where he stood at the plate. I wouldn't want to get him upset. I'd just let him stand up there and say, okay, anywhere you want to stand, here it is.
Some of the Orioles, even last night.
Second base. No play.
What they were talking about in the Oriole dugout, or today when we came to the ballpark, they felt like this ball club, they had Eddie Murray, who hadn't had a hit in 29-something postseason. And the first time up, Dotson blew him, knocked him back with a fastball, and Jim Dwyer sitting on the bench, he said, he just might have woken Murray up.
Mm-hmm.
Bang, home run.
Yeah.
So if you've got somebody who you're getting out pretty consistently.
Here's your on-deck hitter. That's Todd Cruz. The 1-1 to Dower. Hmm. 2-1 now. Fielder waiting out there is Pachoric, and that will be the second out of the inning.
Richie right on it. Line drive. Pachoric had him played just right.
Coming in now will be Todd Cruz, and Todd's been up 11 times. He's had two base hits. This is the Dower swing and the line drive to left fielder Pachoric, who really didn't have to move much at all. Well, the Orioles had a base runner in the first inning, couldn't move him along. They've had two of them on with nobody out here in the second inning and haven't been able to move him. And here's Todd Cruz. Reneke's lead at first base. Murray leading second base with two down. Ball one, Todd. Pretty good breeze. Kind of blowing in from center field. And then if you look over the first base pavilion, it looks to be blowing from the left field corner to the right field corner. And the shortstop, Dibzinski. And that's the force of Reneke for the final out at the end of an inning and a half. Baltimore nothing and Chicago nothing. The winner of today's Big Mac attack, the candidate is going to be Betty Meister of Meadow Road of Ritchie Highway McDonald's. And she will win $100 a run if the Orioles win and $50 a run if they lose.
White Sox struggling for a run. Two earned runs this series. They've left 25 base runners over the first three games stranded. This is Greg Luzinski, 2-for-10 on the series.
And a ball one to the big strong fella. And he is that. A ball to strike now to Greg. If the White Sox were to get in the World Series, what do they do with this fella? Play him at first base?
Yeah, they tried him late in the season at first base. His wife's afraid of him playing first base, though. She thinks he's going to get hurt over there. Tell you one thing he did, though. He wore his helmet out to play first base. So
did he really?
Yeah, he had to play first base with his helmet on.
He's a lot smarter than you give him credit for being. Now the 2-1. 2-2.
Someone asked Singleton, how do you think Luzinski would play first base? And he said, well, he didn't get the nickname Bull for anything.
Now the 2-2. Breaking ball, strike three. He got the curve over, and Luzinski, without comment, is headed for the dugout. That's the first strikeout of the afternoon for Storm Davis. And the batter now, the good swinging Tom Pechorek. He's just hit well against the Orioles all year. And here's the curveball, or the breaking ball, that gets the Bull for, look at that pitch, Brooks.
It's just not much you can do if you're a hitter. You think it's going to be a ball, then when you see it's a strike, you start to react, and it's too late. It just kind of paralyzes you. And this is Tom Pechorek, and I like to see guys like Pechorek do well in the big leagues. He's had a up-and-down career. Started out with the Dodgers originally. Traded. Atlanta gave him his release and went to Seattle, played better. And he's having a banner year the last few years here in Chicago. Baltimore Colts drafted this fella, too. I think he's out of Michigan University. Two balls a strike, one away. Bottom half of the second inning, nothing to nothing.
Ripken will try. And he did it. What an arm on the Orioles shortstop, Cal Ripken. We've seen that arm demonstrated frequently over the course of the season.
Well, you're not going to play shortstop any better than Ripken played it this year. As big as he is, here you see Cruz on his way. Cannot come up with it. Ripken backhands the ball in the hole. Comes up firing.
Notice the footwork the minute the ball was in the glove, the shift of the feet, and then the good strong throw.
Well, that is the key for infielders, is to get themselves in a throwing position as they're feeling the ball.
Here's a good young swinger in the White Sox uniform, and this is his first start of the series. You're looking at Greg Walker.
Played with Kittle in Edmondson last year, but you're going to see this is going to be their regular first baseman in years to come. Did not have that outstanding a year, but everyone that sees him says he is going to hit. He's going to hit for a big average and going to be a good player.
Tell you one thing, he looks like a guy who comes out of the dining room swinging. Threw pitches, two very good-looking swings. He had 270 in 118 games. Now, that's a pretty good two-strike pitch. One ball, two strikes. Now, he had 16 doubles, three triples, 10 home runs, and knocked in 55. And I'd say that's a pretty fair year for young Greg Walker.
Well, La Russa says the more he plays, the tougher it becomes not to write his name in that lineup. And he played quite a bit this year. Pechorek alternated at first base, played the outfield some, but this is the first baseman of the future.
3-2. Well, Davis went out in front 0-2, and now Walker has battled back to get the count filled. 3-2. Two out, nobody on, no score. Bottom of the second inning, game four. He's walked him. A two-out walk to Walker. They'll bring up Vance Law.
I don't know what that pitch was, but I think they're giving Walker a little too much credit. After he got him two strikes and no balls, he went to the breaking pitch one time too often. Early in the game, you make him hit his way on.
Well, here's Vance. He's had a hit in seven trips in the three games to date. And defensively, he has had a little difficulty on occasion. Strike one.
Outfield shifted around towards right field. You get a lot of fly balls from Vance Law. Right center is his where he hits a lot of balls. And we've got that covered pretty well.
ball apparently slipped through Rick and hit his shin guard, and plate umpire Evans says, better let me look at the ball. He's going to do it right now. One ball, one strike. A lot of us were up kind of early this morning here in Chicago, and the weather before daylight was very wet and windy and cold, but the weather forecasts say that it will get better throughout the day. And we can see a couple of patches of blue right now. Oh, yes. Good pitch from Storm. One ball, two strikes. Now, he had Greg Walker 0-2 a moment ago, and he lost him. He walked him. Now he's got a ball and two strikes to Vance Law, the right-handed hitter. Let's see what happens. He came right after him. Bounce to Ripken this time. There's the force at second base, and that is the final out of the inning. At the end of two innings of play in Chicago, game four, Orioles nothing, White Sox nothing. Well, here we go. Equitable Bank home run sweepstakes inning. And if an Oriole batter hits a home run during this inning, a lucky fan is going to win $1,800 unless it happens to be a grand slam or a bases loaded home run, and then the money goes from $1,800 to $1,000,000. And I guess it'd be perfectly all right to express a desire on behalf of Brooks Robinson and yours truly that this is the last Equitable Bank home run derby of the year.
That's right.
And to give away $1,000,000 would be just terrifical. But to give away $1,800 wouldn't be bad either. Glenn C. Harbaugh of Hagerstown is our candidate right now, and Rick Dempsey is batting for Glenn C. Harbaugh of Hagerstown with $1,800 available if Dempsey hits one out of here, and Britt Burns starts him with a strike.
Dempsey 1-for-8 this championship series.
One ball, one strike. Dempsey is batting for Glenn C. Harbaugh of Hagerstown. This afternoon's contestants were selected at random from users of Equitable's 24-hour response machines or response banking phones. Now the shortstop, Dibzinski, and he throws out Dempsey.
It's one of the changes that Russo's made today, getting Dibzinski in the lineup as shortstop. Fletcher 0-for-7 in the series. Trying to get a little more punch from that bottom half of the lineup.
No home run, Glenn Harbaugh, but you get a couple of tickets to a future Orioles game, courtesy of the Orioles and Equitable Bank. And the top of the batting order, represented by John Shelby, and John is going to bat for Neil Wilson of Salisbury, Maryland. Neil Wilson, good luck to you. One out, nobody on, no score. Top of the third inning, game four. Shelby indicated that he wanted to bunt and didn't get the bat out of the way, and the plate umpire Evans, right on top of the play, runs up a strike. And you can take a look at this.
Take another
look at it again.
It's a close call.
Well, some of them go for you, some again you.
Shelby beat out a base hit to third base the first time up. Orioles two hits in this ball game. Eddie Murray, line shot to left field for the other hit. It's a look at the oldest park in the American League.
73 years old.
Hasn't changed much.
John Shelby batting for Neil Wilson of Salisbury with a count, a ball and two strikes. Mr. Wilson could win $1,800 if Shelby happens to yank one out of here. Kind of tough to do today. That wind has been blowing in strongly from center field and left field. Seems to be letting down a little bit now. That'll make it two balls, two strikes. And that's defensively the way the White Sox play the Orioles center fielder Shelby. Out of play. Saw Tito Landrum on deck behind Shelby a moment ago. Two balls, two strikes to John.
Tell you the truth, I don't remember Shelby hitting too many balls right-handed to right center field, but I guess that against the White Sox, he must have, or they wouldn't be playing there.
Yeah, all of that information, as you mentioned last night, is fed into the computer. And Shelby is out on strikes. No home run, Neil Wilson of Salisbury, but you get two free tickets to a future Orioles game, courtesy of the Orioles and Equitable Bank.
This is just an outstanding pitch. It's a curveball. It goes to the outside part of the plate.
Boy, wasn't it a great pitch. And the batter now is going to be Tito Landrum, and he's going to bat for Joseph Shaviro of Baltimore. Joseph Shaviro, good luck to you. Ball one to Landrum, hit into a forced play in the first trip to the plate this afternoon.
Tried to bunt. One hopper back to the pitcher for Shelby at second base.
And look along the Oriole dugout. Dempsey on one side, Storm Davis on the other, of Joe Aldavelli. They got it up in the air, and this will be interesting.
Julio Cruz.
Here's Cruz. He's going to look out. All right, Cruz made the catch. But that win made it very interesting. No home run, Joseph Shaviro. Two free tickets to a future Orioles game, courtesy of the Orioles and Equitable Bank. And that is it. That is our home run derby for today. No home run hit. If we have one for you tomorrow, it'll be worth $1,900. And now at the end of two and a half, the score continues. Baltimore nothing, Chicago. It'll be Jerry Dibzinski leading off in the bottom of the third inning for the Chicago Sox.
Jerry came to Chicago from the Cleveland Indians and has added a little stability to that infield. Alternated with Fletcher most of the year. Finally, they settled in with Fletcher, and Jerry has been in and out of the lineup.
He came over from the Indians and exchanged infielder Pat Tabler. Went the other way.
Okay, Tabler started the spring with the White Sox and had a good spring, and very surprising that they didn't try him at third base, but they felt like defensively he might be lacking some.
Well, Ripken's throw, he kind of gave it a sidearm flip, and it just was sinking, and Murray did a darn good job to pull it out of the dirt. After the throw, Ripken just stood there and kind of said he could buy his posture. Now watch the throw. It sails. He cut it.
Oh, that's a,
what a heck of a play Murray made, huh?
Well, he sure did. He saved him last night on a double play ball, too. He had to stretch out, short hop a ball.
Well, Rip would like to, you know, he would like to be able to just take the time to get right up on top of every throw. And every once in a while, you don't think you have that much time, and you hurry it, and that's what can happen to you. Julio Cruz. Julio hitting 111 in the three games. He's been up nine times with a hit. Ball and a strike.
Switch hitting infield acquired from Seattle earlier in the year.
Two balls and a strike now. Gets the crowd a little lively right now.
Cruz fourth in the American League in stolen bases. Over 50 this year.
Well, right now we're going to pause 5 seconds for station identification on this, the Orioles 83 Baseball Network.
Thorner, Benton, Saunders, Phillips. Watch the team work on Channel 2.
Well, this is a perfect situation for Rudy Law, and it's a perfect situation for the White Sox to get something started. The way they've been swinging the bats and scoring runs, you've got to make something happen if you're a manager. And in this situation, Rudy Law, with a man with a player who runs like Julio Cruz, if you're the hitter, you're going to get more fastballs than you would normally.
False start from Julio at first base. He put the brakes on, and the strike is called a Rudy Law, who stole 77, and Julio stole 57. And the pressure right there on that fella, Rick Dempsey, and he loves it. He just loves a chance to cut down good runners like Cruz and like the man at the plate, Rudy Law, Ricky Henderson.
You see Rudy, who in this series has pulled the ball quite a bit. And it gives him, he's got a big space, big spot between Murray and Dower if he hits the ball sharply. There they go.
There he goes. Dempsey's throw is not going to be in time and high.
You are just not going to stop guys like Cruz and Law from stealing. They're going to steal their bases. You see Dempsey, it looks like that he just lets the ball go high.
Ball kind of slipped out of his grasp, that's all. He didn't have
let it go high, and Cruz is in with a stolen base. He's in even if it's a good throw.
Probably would have been. So with one out and a runner at second base, the count two strikes to the batter, Rudy Law.
Go ahead, run at second.
Well hit to right field. Chasing it is Landrum. He's got it. Now tagging its second and racing for third goes Julio Cruz. Cruz was halfway down the line when Landrum made the grab.
Well, Rudy Law hit that ball about as far as he can hit it to right field. Tito, they were playing him, bunching him in right center field. Tito had to go a long way to bring it down. Cruz had time to go back, tag up. Now he got to go ahead, run at third. Fisk is up, base hit the last time. Here you see Landrum back, makes the play.
That's about as far away from the infield as you can get out there, where Landrum made his throw. Cruz had absolutely no difficulty in getting to third. Now here's Carlton Fisk. I don't know where that pitch was, but it looked awfully good.
Yes, it did. I can tell you one thing, Chuck. Rudy Law is a better player than I thought he was. I'm gaining a little more respect for him every time he comes up, because he has been on just about everything that the Orioles have thrown him. That was the curveball he hit off of Davis, and he hit it right on the nose.
And the 1-0 pitch to Fisk. One now. I'll tell you something, looking at those pennants atop the right field pavilion, that wind is really blowing in over the left field pavilion, right into the face of the right-handed hitters. And the 1-1. Well, the wind is going to drive this around. Eddie Murray should make the play on the first base side, and he does for the final out at the end of three. Baltimore nothing, Chicago nothing. Now let's look into the select boxes that are available to patrons here in Chicago's Comiskey Park. I think this is going to be done down in Arlington, Texas. The Rangers are doing it. Of course, it's available for you in Cleveland's ballpark now. And at Fenway Park in Boston, they have added it. And I would think perhaps in the future that you could see this in Memorial Stadium in Baltimore. It's a very comfortable way to entertain customers and guests and see, you know, Major League Baseball. Well, let's take a look now at Cal Ripken leading off in the top of the fourth inning of a 0-0 ball game. Britt Burns is that big left-hander, and he's been doing just an outstanding job. The Orioles have two base hits, and the White Sox have one, a first inning single by Carlton Fisk. Shelby had an infield hit in the first inning. Oh, boy.
Cal's hit in every ball game so far. Two base hits last night, one a ringing double to right center field. It hit about halfway up on a right center field fence.
Well, for the first time this afternoon, we see a little bit of sunshine. And the 1-1 to Ripken. As I mentioned earlier, the left-hander you're watching is not at all hesitant about coming inside. He will bring it in there. That's his third strikeout. And you'd have to say that Burns is pitching the way you would hope a pitcher would go in a game that is an absolute must for his team.
Oh, that's a breaking ball, and it's awful hard, Chuck. We haven't seen him change speeds as much as I thought we were. He's just relied on his fast breaking ball. It's like a slider, and his good fastball.
One out, nobody on. Eddie Murray, the batter. Your nearby Dotson dealers will donate $100 per Oriole telecast to the favorite charity of the Dotson Player of the Game. And the Oriole player will be selected at the end of the game by Brooks Robinson and yours truly. Ball one to Eddie. And during this exciting playoff series, we kind of hope that you'll choose along with us as we try to select the Dotson Player of the Game. And you notice he came right inside to Murray on his first pitch. Checked his swing, didn't get the bat out of the way, and here is the second out of the game. Second out of the inning, and the batter is Greinke.
Sox one hit, Orioles two hits. There you'll see Cruz takes his time.
Greinke was walked on four pitches right behind Eddie Murray's leadoff single in the second inning. Ball one. Seems that both Britt Burns and Storm Davis have settled into a pretty good groove.
Almost reminds me of the 66 World Series in a way, Chuck. Although the Orioles won four in a row, they had the lowest team batting average ever in a World Series for a winning team, and the Dodgers had the lowest team batting average ever for a losing team. And right now, both these ball clubs are below 200.
And the 1-2 pitch on the way to Gary Greinke from Britt Burns, and he's really throwing good. Looks like every now and then he almost turns the ball over a little bit. That might be kind of a changeup for Britt. Not really a, I don't know, it looks a little bit like a screwball, but. Now the 2-2 pitch.
He scored 11 runs on 8 hits last night.
Mm-hmm. Three and two.
Just wild enough to make him even a little more effective. Yep.
Well, he's got a full count, 3-2. He's retired 8 in a row now, as Burns. Walks Greinke again. That's his second walk. Both times it's been Greinke, and the batter now is going to be Ken Singleton. Last time he worked to Singleton, he just powered the fastball right by him.
Tony La Russa having a chat with someone on the bench, and I think that's the way you got to pitch a single, especially right-handed. I think you just throw as hard as you can most of the time. Singleton, in talking to him, he had a lot of fastballs for base hits off of this Chicago White Sox staff, and he felt like going into this series here, he was going to see a lot of breaking balls. The first few games, he did. And when you start throwing him off speed stuff, breaking balls, you're going right to what he wants you to do.
Here's Dipczynski's throw to first, and that takes care of Singleton for the final out. At the end of 3.5 in game 4, the Orioles nothing, the White Sox nothing. Well, in the bottom of the fourth inning at Comiskey, Harold Baines is the new batter. And Baines, Luzinski, Pechorek are the new hitters against Baltimore's Storm Davis.
I think that sign said it all. Oh, for the long one. I think they'd like to get on the board first, too, don't you, Chuck?
The guy that scored first so far in the series has been able to win the game. White Sox scored first in the opening game and won it. Since that time, the Orioles have scored first. Well, this is going to be a base knocker. Is Renicky getting there? Did he
Great
make that
play.
Catch?
Yes, he did. Catch. Unbelievable.
What
Just
a catch
a
he made.
Fantastic. That ball was fading away from Renicky. He had to dive.
I hope he's all right.
Well, I do, too. Looks like he's real. Here you see Gary. This is just one great play, especially when it's slicing away from you.
To turn the glove over that way and hang on. And the umpire, Durwood Merrill, was, you know, like 10 yards away from him when he made the call. And no doubt about it.
And Harold
just
Baines,
brilliant.
Harold Baines has to be one. I mean, that's the last five times up, Chuck. He has hit the ball right on the nose, and they have been stellar plays to get him.
Well, the first time up, he ripped the line drive into a double play in the first inning, and now another line drive, and Renicky makes just a brilliant defensive play, and the batter is Luzinski, and the curveball is outside. Ball one. I was sure that was a base hit, and then I said, wait a minute. That fella covers so much ground. He doesn't look as though he's going that hard, but he really is swift and covers a heck of a lot of ground. The wind will blow this one way back into the seats. A ball to strike to the bull. Like most of the big, strong guys, he's a very quiet individual. He doesn't have a whole lot to say. That's that good bat talk for him. Davis is a 1-1 offering to Luzinski. Well, I don't know whether Dempsey will have a play. Yes, he will. The wind's driving it around. Look out. Dempsey was really upset. He said, well, let me tell you something, he said, Chuck. He said, the first one, he said, I butchered. He said, man, that was a terrible play. He said, but the other one, the warning track on the third base side slopes very sharply toward the box seat railing, and it's kind of, you're kind of going downhill. He said, and I knew I was in trouble. He said, and then when I put the brakes on and they didn't hold, it was all over. But the wind, as you said, Chris Everett gets out there with a tennis racket and knocks it back. That's a pretty good way to, if it gets above the roof, could be very interesting. Here is Pechorek. All the curveball. Pitchers battle through the first three innings. This afternoon in game four in Chicago, Britt Burns and Storm Davis. Now let's see what the wind will do to this. Everybody trying for it. Murray is trying to stay with it. It's into the seats. My goodness, that ball blew in there. It did look like somebody hit it with a tennis racket. It was, you know, seemingly in play, and then all of a sudden, like it hit the side of a house. It just caromed off and went into the seats. Here, now watch Eddie Murray. Now he figures, whoops, wait a minute.
Look, he's...
Yeah, he's turning around.
He's whatever. Like, can you believe that?
What am I doing over here when that ball's 20 rows back on the seats? Palmer just kind of loosening up out in the Oriole bullpen. Palmer would like to be ready. He would like to contribute. Now the two-strike pitch to Pechorek. Good pitch.
Pechorek has given the Orioles a lot of trouble over the years. Over this year especially. He hit in 25 of his last 27 games this season. Tough guy to strike out. Sprays the ball around. Got a pretty good idea of what he wants to do. There's a good shot of Palmer. Might be an indication that in talking to Ray Miller, we just said we're hoping that's a...
Uh-oh. Little check swing into left field. Renicky can't get there. One of those excuse me base hits, and they are just as valuable as the line drives. Tom tried to check the bat, couldn't get it out of the way. A two out single by Pechorek brings up Greg Walker, and against Storm Davis with two out and nobody on in the second inning, he got a free ticket. Davis walking. And they're partner said maybe they're giving this fellow a little too much credit. Come after him, challenge him a little more. Well, let's see if they've changed their mind somewhat now with a man on base. Ball.
Where Dempsey wanted it. You saw him put down one finger, then point to the outside. That meant fastball away, and he got it right where he held his glove.
Two and one now. A healthy Storm Davis, a very valuable commodity. If this young man stays healthy, what a brilliant future is ahead of him. And the 2-1. The one thing I suspect that he'll be working on somewhat is to do a little better job of fielding his position. But if it affects his delivery, then you can't worry about it. Out of play. In other words, as Brooks pointed out, you just can't sacrifice, for the sake of fielding a ground ball, your natural manner and effective manner of throwing to the plate.
2-2 and two away.
Boy, this fella goes a hacking and a slashing, doesn't
he? Well, he does. Yes, that was a breaking ball to him and got out in front, but what he did is kept the bat back, still had a lot of swing left.
And the 2-2 pitch. Out of play. Wait a minute. I'm thinking about that wind. Maybe I spoke too soon, but it's way up on the roof. Runner at first base, Tom Pachorik, two out on the bottom of the fourth. No score here in game four. Storm Davis to Greg Walker. Well, this is the second time that Storm's gone to a full count against Walker.
Pants low on deck.
Struck him out, and the inning is over. At the end of four, the Orioles nothing and the White Sox nothing. Well, on top of the fifth inning, Dower, Cruz, and Dempsey are coming up, and we want you to remember that coming up in this inning, it's Coke break time, and Coke is it. Dower, fly to left field in his first at-bat against Britt Burns. And I'll tell you what, Tony La Russa has no complaint about the game that Britt Burns is giving him. Pitching a two-hitter, another shutout, and the same thing is true of Storm Davis. Pitching has been the name of the game in the early going. No count now. Two balls, no strikes. Sun popping out briefly. The 2-0 to Dower. Oh, good play by Law. And that takes care of Dower. Very good play by the White Sox third baseman, Vance Law. Ball took one of those peculiar hops down there. He stayed with it and made the play.
Well, he does. Here you'll see it smashed right on the ground. Gets his glove down, stays with it. Makes a good throw to first base.
One up and one down. And the batter now is going to be Todd Cruz. Hard throwing southpaw, Britt Burns.
13-5 last year against the American League. A major league lifetime career is 48-37.
The Orioles on the season against left-handed twirlers, 125. They lost 19. White Sox, 37 wins against left-handed pitching, 19 losses. Two strikes to Cruz. That's the fourth strikeout. To bring up Rick Dempsey. Dempsey in his only at-bat in the third inning was out on a bouncer to the shortstop. That pitch looked like it might have been a bit out of the strike zone. Matter of fact, looked like it bounced in front of the plate.
It did.
It really looked that way. And now Dempsey. That's the story on your pitching right now. 33-32 strike ball ratio, 65 pitches for Britt Burns into the fifth inning. And he's two-thirds of the way through it. Head of Dempsey, two strikes. The Orioles had a scratch hit, an infield hit in the first inning, and they had a line drive single off the bat of Eddie Murray in the second, and that's been it. Burns, after a walk to Renicki, retired eight in a row before he walked Renicki again. Now this one's going to find a home in the outfield grass, and Dempsey has a base hit, a two-out single. To bring up the leadoff batter, John Shelby, who had the scratch hit, infield hit in the first inning, called out on strikes in the third inning. And Dempsey and Pachoric having, or rather Dempsey and Walker having a little conversation at first base.
This ballpark has always been primarily a pitcher's park. They've helped the hitters in some degree by moving home plate out about 10, 12 feet, make it a little shorter.
Still, it's a big old ballpark. It really is. And ball one to John. 401 feet to the center field wall. 374 in the power alleys, right and left center. 341 down the foul lines, right field and left field.
We've seen him change center field several times in the last few years. One time, it went all the way to the wall, 440-something feet, foul back.
Up against the press box, and they've got the windows down this afternoon in Chicago. Print media over there going to stay warm. I don't blame them.
I think they had a vote. They had a straw vote over there, and the guys who wanted it down won.
I'll tell you what. Somebody said they wanted the windows open today. You better go pick up his card. Now the 1-1 pitch, no. Burns keeping an eye on Dempsey at first base. If there is a game five, Mr. Hoyt and Scott McGregor.
I was going to say the forecast is for a good day tomorrow. Sunshine. If there is no game five, we'll see you back in Baltimore tonight. Mm.
Now the 1-1 pitch. Well, the wind are going to knock this around. Let's watch your first baseman, Walker, and the catcher,
Walker
Fisk.
Walker and Fisk after it, both of them.
And Fisk makes the catch. And that's the final out. Now at the end of 4.5 innings of play at Chicago nothing, Baltimore nothing. And now, fans, let us take a Coke break. Well, on the bottom of the fifth inning at Comiskey Park here in Game 4, Storm Davis now will have to take on the bottom end of the batting order. Vance Law, Jerry Dibzinski, and Julio Cruz. Law hit into a forced play to end the second inning. Dubczynski was out on a bouncer to Ripken at short. Cruz walked and stole a base the last time he batted in the third inning.
Davis moving right along. This is the bottom of the fifth. Palmer still warming up in the bullpen.
I got a feeling he'll start every inning with the...
Well, I think Storm. You're right. You know, they were really not concerned about Storm, but they were hoping for five or six good, strong innings. Maybe he'll go nine, but they wanted five or six, and he has given them that so far.
One of the things that the Orioles are concerned with, insofar as Storm Davis, there isn't a ball game that's worth sacrificing this young man's career, and they want to be very sure that he doesn't throw too many pitches under adverse conditions that could in any way have an effect on his career. And that's probably the reason that Palmer is staying limber out in that bullpen, because they're keeping a very, very close watch on Storm Davis.
And if he makes it through seven or eight, well, then you got Tippy ready to go. He's...
Well, Storm Davis says, hey, don't put a limit on me. Just let's see how we go.
Yep.
Well, that must be a frustrating feeling. Now you see it, now you don't. That's as bad a swing as I've had seen Vance Law take in a little while. But Davis has made some.
Oh, I tell you, Vance is, he's got a nice easy swing, Chuck, but it doesn't have to be that quick, mainly because he's trying to hit the ball the other way. There's a ground ball to third base.
And that'll be the first out. And the batter will be Jerry Dubczynski. Jerry has handled himself very well in the field. One time at bat, he has grounded a shortstop.
Played in 127 games this year, hit .230, one home run.
Fair foul, going to be a foul ball and out of play. Strike one to Jerry. Two down. Julio Cruz walked in the third inning. Squinting, there's just a little bit of a glare out there on the field this afternoon. Can Murray get there? No way. Base hit for Cruz. Now that'll bring up leadoff hitter Rudy Law.
Murray was the only one who had a chance for that ball. Dower playing up the middle at second base. He played Cruz around towards left field. He just pulled this ball in the hole. And I'm sure that Rudy Law is going to be giving Julio Cruz a chance to steal a base early in the count. Stole one the last time.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. Runs are at a premium this afternoon at Comiskey Park. With Britt Burns and young Storm Davis, they are very tough. Now Law has grounded a second and fly deep to right in two previous trips. Ball one.
I don't think Cruz knows that much about stealing. He just steals mainly on instinct, Chuck. It's not that he...
He's just got that blinding speed.
Yeah, he does. Rudy Law, on the other hand, the hitter here, I think he studies the pitchers just a little more. But he's got a great start. Law is, you'll see Cruz taking a little more this time than he did the last time. Now, if you're Dempsey, what are you going to tell yourself? I want to get that ball as fast as I can. Therefore, I might see Law all fastballs this time.
Yep, two balls and no strikes behind in the count to Rudy Law. This fellow's had a mess of base hits in this series.
There he goes.
There he goes.
Is that
wild
a no, pitch?
That's
wild
a wild pitch.
Yep.
But he will not have a chance to go to third. He expected the throw, anticipating it, and went into the slide at second base.
This ball was up and in, almost over Rudy's head, to the backstop. Cruz diving into second base.
Well, you've got two out in the inning, and the walk to Cruz, you have to be concerned with Cruz's speed. You can't ignore it. But you've got to work on this hitter. Three balls, no strikes. And behind him, Carlton Fisk. This is the...
I'll tell you what, as hot as Law's been...
They've had a man on base every inning this afternoon, have the White Sox.
As hot as Law's been, I wouldn't be surprised to see him have a whack at this 3-0 pitch.
Yeah, he did. 3-1 now.
I mean, he has been the offense for the White Sox, Rudy Law.
Coming into this afternoon's game, Rudy has hit .538. 3-1 to Law. Strike two, 3-2. Well, getting behind 3-0 and catching up 3-2. Raw, cold wind whistling through Comiskey Park this Saturday afternoon. It really hasn't had too much of an effect on the baseball.
3-2, two away. Go ahead, run at second base. Pop him up to center field.
And Shelby's having wind trouble. Wind trouble. And he made the catch.
He
got kind of a weak reading on that one, and only Shelby's speed saved him. At the end of five, Baltimore nothing and Chicago nothing. Sixth inning, Tito Landrum and Cal Ripken and Eddie Murray against Britt Burns. Burns and Storm Davis own the ball game this afternoon through the first five innings. Britt Burns has stopped the Orioles cold on three base hits through the first five, and the same thing is true of Storm Davis, shutting out the White Sox on three hits. The White Sox have had a man on base every inning this afternoon, and the Orioles have had a man on base every inning except the third. But getting them on is one thing. Scoring them is quite a different thing.
Well, this is Tito Landrum, and for some reason, I feel like a push-bunt attempt right here. Just got a feeling.
To rattle the bats, try to do something to get...
Nope.
Burns really have been throwing very well, giving his club the kind of an effort they hope that he could give them today.
He is sneaky. I mean, he is nice and easy, and then he pops it right over the top. He gets there up on you and in a hurry.
Haven't seen the radar gun today, but he's throwing it pretty hard up there. And he's gotten as many strikes over the inside portion of the plate as he has anywhere else, if not more.
Of his 10 wins, four of them were shutouts.
1-2 pitch to Landrum. Dibczynski just could not get a grip on it to make the throw, and rather than take a chance of throwing it away, he held onto it. A broken bat infield scratch hit for Tito Landrum. Well, you had a feeling, and you were right about Landrum.
Yeah, we've gotten a few breaks today. The White Sox have hit the ball, they've hit the ball a little better than we have, Chuck, and we've been in the right spot today. We've got a couple of scratch hits.
Well, Britt Burns has fanned four so far through his five innings, plus a batter. And Storm Davis has struck out two. And has walked one. Burns has walked Renicky twice. And here is Ripken, hit into a double play, struck out. See if he comes right inside to Ripken again. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Strike one.
Thank you. breaking ball. The reason it's so important to pitch inside on hitters is the fact that, number one, it takes a, if you're going to get the bat head out to hit a ball inside, you've got to get it out a lot, way out in front to hit it. Now, the reason guys don't like to pitch inside is because more mistakes are made in there.
Two-strike pitch to Ripken. And he came right inside again. Just moved him off the plate. And that's all part of pitching. That's the name of the game. And every once in a while, when you do that, a pitch will get away from you and you'll hit somebody.
Well, the hitters know it, you know.
Well, it just, the reaction by Kittle last night was just out of sheer pain and frustration. And by the time he got to first base, he realized, as a matter of fact, the youngster said to the, hey, I just lost my cool. And he takes a man to admit that. 2-2 now to Ripken. And he's a very sore young man today. And we just hope that that knee is going to be all right.
Well, I thought it took a lot for Dotson to admit that he hit him on purpose.
Yeah, Dotson said that the orders came down through the grapevine. And then he said they had a lottery in the dugout to figure out who he was supposed to hit.
Well, he totally lost his composure. If you're going to hit a guy in a playoff like this, you just don't do that. You file it, put it in your file, and
that's right.
Do it next year. But it really took them right out of the ball game when he hit Ripken after two away. Then he threw inside to Murray, start another little ruckus, and then he threw the next three balls, or nowhere close. And he went 0-2 on Lowenstein, and Lowenstein blew the game wide open. So it really cost him.
Well, Britt now is behind three balls, two strikes. Well, he's not really behind, is he?
3-2, none away.
Carlton Fisk, who has meant quite a little bit to this Chicago pitching staff. And he came under the gun in the first half of the year. People were critical of the way he was handling the pitching staff. They didn't say anything when they went 42-5 in the second half of the year. Look out, Landrum, safe. Boy, it looked like Burns had him. With a better move to first base, he'd have had him.
Well, we know what he's going to do now. He's going to be going, but he did catch him leaning, and only the quick reflexes of Landrum got him back to first base in time. Here you see Tito. He's on his way right now. Uh-oh, I'm in trouble, but he dives back under the throw.
3-2 pitch to Rip. There he goes. Popped him up. It's out of play. It's another angle on the pickoff attempt to get Landrum. He got back with plenty to spare. But the fortunate thing is that his feet did not slip as he started back.
Top of the sixth. Four hits for the Orioles, three for the Sox. Burns and Davis, letter perfect.
Landrum hadn't got that big a lead against this left-hander Burns. 3-2 to Ripken, there he goes. Ball four.
Ball four.
Ball four. Walk number three, issued by Britt Burns. I'll tell you, Brooks, we're a long way from the plate. Boy, that looked like a good pitch.
Well, I tell you what, Fisk and Burns thought it was, you know, Ripken. Landrum on the way. Ripken took it like it was ball four all the way, but I have a hunch it was a little closer than everybody anticipated. You don't see Fisk putting up much of a squawk, but he did.
Here's the pitch right here. Look.
This is a breaking ball.
Well, that was pretty close, but I can see that might have been a little bit outside, but when the count's 3-2. Scary. Now the Orioles with nobody out and runners at first and second base and Eddie Murray. Without a doubt, the best opportunity they've had so far this afternoon. Murray, in his last at-bat, or rather in the second inning, lined to left field for a base hit, and the last time on a check swing, bounced a ground ball to the second baseman, Cruz.
Last time up, that's where he got Murray inside both pitches.
Yep.
Tried the check swing, as you mentioned, Chuck.
He's been coming inside to Ripken, too. He's come inside to a lot of the Oriole hitters and has handled them very well. Strike one.
Well, Eddie is standing up on the plate, too. He's, yep. There's Rojas now warming. He's got his back foot. He's opened up a lot more than he usually does from both sides, in fact. And he knows where Burns wants to bring this ball to. He knows he's trying to get inside.
A ball to strike to Eddie. They tried to get Murray to talk about the episodes in last night's game, and Eddie said politely, thank you very much, but no comment.
He was the coolest guy out there, just kind of leaning back on his bat and relaxing.
Murray felt that that pitch was somewhat inside. Not beefing that much about it. Take a look at it. Yeah, that looked like a darn good pitch. Excellent pitch. And Burns has made a lot of those pitches, particularly to the inside portion of the plate. And as Brooks has pointed out, it takes a lot of courage to do that. If you make a mistake in there, you can really be in trouble. He wants the strikeout right now. Out of play.
Hitter has to be so quick when you got a guy like Burns throwing inside. Don't have much time to make up your mind. Ripken at first base, Tito Landrum at second base, none away.
What a pitch. Just an outstanding pitch. The fifth strikeout for Britt Burns. And here's a guy, he's walked twice, Gary Renicky. He's in a situation now where he's got to pitch to him.
This is a good pitch in a good spot. You'll see Murray, he's already gone, looking for the pitch inside, and it happens to be a breaking ball on the outside part of the plate. He's already spent when the ball goes across the plate. Has to reach for it. Strike three. And this has been the White Sox nemesis all year, Gary Renicky.
Ball one. White Sox can keep the Orioles from scoring in this sixth inning. I think old man Moe will be headed to their dugout. It would be quite an accomplishment if they're able to do that. The Orioles have had a man on every inning except the third. Started this inning with runners at first and second and nobody out.
White Sox have had a couple of runners at second base, but always with two away.
And the 1-0 pitch to Renicky. Member of the Burns family, the lady on the screen. Going to try for two. That's one. Yep, they got the double play, and what a job by Britt Burns. And what a big plus this must be for Chicago at the end of 5.5. Orioles nothing, Chicago nothing. Well, credit where credit is due to Britt Burns for just an outstanding job of pitching. The leadoff scratch hit by Landrum, a follow-up walk to Ripken, and the Orioles had a shot at doing something. To Britt Burns, he got the big man Murray via the strikeout route, and then the double play that ended the inning right here.
Well, what he's doing so well is he is moving the ball not so much up and down, but in and out. And that time he jams Renicky. I did not think they were going to get a double play on that ball, but it sure turned out to be one. And here goes Carlton Fisk leading off the bottom of the sixth inning. Nothing to nothing.
Carlton had an infield hit in the first inning. Got a ball right by pitcher Storm Davis, and Dower made a diving effort behind the bag at second and even tried to throw him out, but couldn't get it there. Then in the third inning, fist popped up to first baseman Eddie Murray.
And you get the feeling the longer this game goes that one swing of the bat is going to decide the fate of this whole ball game.
Now here's Dempsey back to the screen. The wind's probably going to drive it out of play, and it does. I think it came right through the screen. Strike one. Carlton Fisk. Fisk, Harold Baines, Greg Luzinski against Storm Davis in the last half of the sixth. Foul ball. On deck hitter, Harold Baines. Kind of a pitch from Davis on the two strike count.
The unusual little, you know, looking at his face close up like that.
Yeah.
It looked like a twinge of pain.
Like he was a little uncomfortable.
Yeah,
that's right.
You're exactly right.
And that Oriole bullpen. Dennis Martinez is limbering up. Here's the throw from Cruz, and that'll be the first out. Looked like it was Martinez out in that bullpen. Brooks will take a look for us.
Nice fluid over the top.
That's who it is. Harold. That announced Harold Baines. Speaking of fellas who can end a ball game with one swing of the bat, here's Baines. Ball one.
Gotta be wondering what you have to do to get a hit.
Hadn't been a lot of fun for Harold, but he's hit the ball awfully hard. Renicki took the base hit away from him in the fourth inning. And there's a base hit to center field for Baines. And I'll tell you what, he's earned it. One out single for Baines brings up the bull, Luzinski.
Davey Nelson, coach for the White Sox, talking to him. And what they've been doing on Luzinski, been getting inside on him, keeping the ball inside on him, jamming him just about every time he's been at bat. And I'll tell you what he's done, too. He's moved back in the box. He's moved away from the plate even more, realizing that's what they've been trying to do. It's about 4 or 5 inches off of the plate more than he has been in this particular ball game.
It's Dennis Martinez in the Oriole bullpen. Palmer had been up there for a couple of innings.
Right there.
One ball, one strike.
Home runs on the year, the most ever by a designated hitter.
I don't know whether it'd be in play or not, but the wind gets finished with it.
Don't be close.
Dempsey had the play and made it. And now Tom Pachorik, who has grounded to short and singled to left field. I tell you, these two clubs are playing a hard-nosed ball game in Chicago this afternoon. You've got a couple of pitchers in Storm Davis and Britt Burns that just refuse to wilt or fold. They have just thrown the ball very hard and very effectively. No runs, four hits on the board for both the White Sox and the Orioles.
It'll take a little something unusual to win this ball game.
You know, sometimes a bad hop, a break, an error.
For instance, Baines stealing a base. You know, you got to watch him. Give him a look. Something like that's a fly ball.
This is a pop into shallow center. Good ball. Watching Ripken. What a fine play he made. That's it. The end of six. It is Baltimore nothing and Chicago nothing.
Too. The problem is, I hardly ever get to see him because he's always showing game highlights. Wait, there he is.
Football, the Colts won another one yesterday.
Instead of staring back at you, he plays the action. He's the one guy on TV who shows more sports and less of the sportscaster. There he is again.
Meanwhile, let's check the blast highlights.
See what I mean? You ought to catch John Saunders on Channel 2. Or try to.
Well, in one tough ball game, game four of the 1983 American League Championship Series, the Orioles and the White Sox scoreless after six innings. In the seventh inning, Singleton, Dower, Todd Cruz are due against left-hander Britt Burns. Burns and his counterpart, Storm Davis, just hanging up one goose egg after another, have allowed only four base hits and never more than a hit in an inning. And it's a cold, raw, windy afternoon in Chicago, normally not the kind of an afternoon that you would associate with good pitching. But I'll tell you what, it's been nothing but outstanding pitching. And here's Singleton. Singy has struck out and bounced to short. That pitch didn't quite work the way Burns and Fisk wanted it to. Tell you, those fellas have an interesting afternoon, the people in that blimp when the wind is blowing the way it is. Two balls, no strikes.
Law is guarding third base, a third base line a little more now than early in the part of the game. Ball four, and not even close.
That's the fourth walk. And in the late innings of the ball game, you just don't like to start putting people on. And he's walked an Oriole batter in the sixth inning and walked another one here in the seventh inning. And Singleton is coming back into the dugout. We're going to get a pinch runner.
Looks like the B. Al Bumbry.
Bumbry is running for Singleton.
And this is where it becomes key. Get someone at second base. With one away.
B just ran up the dugout steps. That got him warm. He was ready. And let's see if the Orioles aren't going to try and bunt Bumbry down. Yes, sir.
Good one.
Just a perfect bunt. Whoa, look out, Greg. Well, Dower came up in the bunting situation and handled it perfectly.
Oh, we got a little inside joke going up here, but I want to tell you, nice going.
Todd Cruz.
Rich Dower
is the batter. That really was a perfectly placed bunt. I'll tell you what we laughed about. Their rappers are blowing all around home plate. And as the plate umpire, Jim Evans, just walked over and reached down very casually to pick one up, the wind gusted and blew it right through his legs. And now he's chasing another one, and he's got it. Well, two for three. That's a heck of an afternoon, Jim. We're going to pause 5 seconds for station identification on the Orioles 83 Baseball Network.
Marsh, Saunders, Phillips. Watch the 5:30 team work on Channel 2.
Here's Todd Cruz. Cruz has hit into a forced play and struck out in two previous at-bats against the big hard throwing southpaw Burns.
White Sox play Cruz straight away. Bumbry at second base. Go ahead, run.
The on-deck hitter, Rick Dempsey.
Cruz 2-for-11 in this series.
That's a foul ball.
Base hit the first time up against Lamar Hoyt in Baltimore.
Back in the third inning, the White Sox got a runner as far as third base. That's the only guy that's gotten that far this afternoon. Ball, two strikes to Todd Cruz. Burns with another strikeout, number six.
I don't think Burns meant for that ball to be there. It was a high breaking ball is what it was, and that's not the spot for a high breaking ball, but he got Cruz to swing right through it. Here you'll see it. Hangs it upstairs. Wasn't as high as I thought it was, but it was above the belt.
Right in on him. And Cruz had no chance to get the arms extended.
And here's Rick Dempsey.
1-for-2 this afternoon. Well, the Orioles have had their leadoff batter on in the last two innings. They've advanced him to second base and then haven't been able to move him. Strike to Dempsey. Chicago's center fielder, Rudy Law, is playing Dempsey toward the alley in right center field, and their left fielder is way off the line toward the gap in left center field. One strike offering to Dempsey. Ready now with a 1-1. Two out. Bumbry at second. Did he or didn't he? Nope. They say he checked the swing. Two balls and a strike. Dave Phillips umpiring first base. Here's a look at the check swing. Britt Burns right now, here with the two out on the seventh inning, has thrown 101 pitches. He's big enough and strong enough to throw 101 more.
Got Rojas warming in the White Sox bullpen. Tippy Martinez throwing in the Orioles bullpen. And this is the way it should be, right to the wire.
Yeah. You're seeing some class pitching. Last night, the Oriole bats hammered out 11 runs. This afternoon, not able to get a run. Have had plenty of opportunities. Have not been able to break through. 2-2 to Dempsey. Popped him up. Watching the center fielder, Rudy Law. That's the final out. At the end of 6 1/2, it continues. The Orioles nothing and the White Sox nothing.
On the farm is kind of laid back. Ain't much an old country boy like me can't hack. It's early to rise, early in the sack.
Well, you have to give a lot of credit to the White Sox, down 2-1 in games. The Orioles in the second inning of the ball game have runners at first and second base with nobody out. Couldn't break through. The Orioles in the sixth inning had runners at first and second base. Couldn't break through. have had their leadoff hitter on the last two innings. Couldn't get him any farther than second base. Just airtight, hard-nosed pitching from Britt Burns. And that young man on the mound for the Orioles is just matching him pitch for pitch right on through the first six innings.
You're right, Chuck, and there's two guys right now I'm worried about in this White Sox lineup, and this is one of them right now. I'd say Baines and Walker, who is hitting now, are the two guys that scare me most of all the White Sox hitters.
Well, Walker drew a walk in the second inning. He struck out in the fourth inning, and here he is in the bottom of the seventh of a scoreless ball game.
He, along with Baines, have had the best swings off of Starm Davis all day. And if you're going to hit one today, I've got a feeling it's going to be to right instead of left, because the wind is blowing in a pretty good gale from left.
Two balls, no strikes. Pitching coach Ray Miller watching his youngster. The Orioles have really, really been concentrating on Storm this afternoon. They just want to be very sure that in the heat of the battle, and for the sake of one ball game, that he doesn't hurt himself, that could in any way, you know, jeopardize what's going to be an outstanding career. And Storm obviously has not been hurting and has pitched extremely well. Three balls, one strike.
3-1. Tough pitch right here. I think you can look for Davis to try to stay away from Walker. Fastball, looks like he wants it away. Moving outside.
Base hit. Now it'll be Vance Law, and his job will be to move that man to second base. And they're going to get a runner.
Right, Mike Squires going in to run.
Mike Squires.
Martinez Tippy warming in the bullpen.
They were trying to go outside with Walker. He was right on it. He just took the ball right where it was pitched, and here comes Altavelli. Joe is on his way to the mound. I think Tippy Martinez is ready in the Oriole bullpen. Storm Davis, the base hit by Greg Walker, was the fifth of the ball game. They've all been singles. Fisk had an infield hit in the first inning. And then a line drive base hit to left by Pashorek in the fourth inning. An infield hit by Julio Cruz bounced one between Murray and Dower into right field in the fifth inning. And Baines hammered one through the middle to center field for a base knock in the sixth. And now Squires running for Walker, who hit a line shot to the gap in left center field, and that's going to be it for Storm Davis. We are going to have a pitching change here in Chicago. And while the new pitcher makes his way to the mound, let us pause for these words. Well, Storm Davis has given the Orioles just another great effort. Six innings plus a man in the seventh, five hits, a pair of walks, a pair of strikeouts, and did not allow a run. And from the pen now comes Tippy Martinez, his second appearance in the 1983 championship series. He came on Wednesday afternoon, pitched two innings of relief, didn't give up a base hit. He walked two and struck out one. And on the year, Tippy Martinez, well, it's kind of hard to speculate as to wonder what might have happened to the Orioles had not Tippy had the sort of a season that he enjoyed. He was time after time winning nine, losing three, a total of 21 saves, 103 and a third innings of relief work this year. Tippy pitched to an earned run of 2.35 in 103 innings. He walked 37 men while striking out 81. He just did the job time after time after time.
If you're a manager, you go with what got you here. And Tippy is the fellow who came out of the bullpen, as Chuck said, time after time to do it. The Orioles have had some opportunities today and have not been able to cash in on them.
Well, the White Sox, you would figure, with the Squires running at first base and the lower end of the batting order, they were going to go, should probably and will go, to the bunting game. Tippy.
It's not that Squires has that much speed, because he doesn't. He's a very average runner. He'll be sticking around to play first base,
right,
which he does very well. But Law can handle the bat, makes contact. Doesn't have to be a bunt, but it's going to be.
Ball one.
Martinez not the easiest guy in the world to bunt either.
I just can't imagine them not bunting in this situation. Vance hit into a force, grounded a third in two previous turns against Storm Davis. And Tippy again to first base.
I wonder who we got to pinch hit today. Got Dobzinski, the next hitter. And then Cruz might get a hitter for the shortstop. There they go.
How
base
about
hit.
That? Base hit. In an obvious punting situation, they swing away, and Vance Law delivers.
Now we mentioned before, it might take something unusual, and everybody playing for the bunt.
That's exactly what you have to do. Make something happen. And La Russa and the White Sox gambled, and they win. That could have just as well been a double play ground ball, but
Tippy,
it was a base hit.
Yeah, Tippy, that's exactly right. Tippy going for the heart of the plate after throwing ball one, and with the bunt in the order, La Russa gambled, it paid off. First and second, no one out. Another obvious bunt sequence right here.
Shoelace at second base, and a concerned Altavelli.
Dennis Martinez throwing in the Oreo bullpen. If you're Dobzinski, what you want to do is try to make the third baseman feel this ball. Murray way in on the grass.
Dempsey was tempted, but didn't want to take the chance on the bad throw that could really wreck the hopes of the Orioles to get out of this. Strike one. Nope, they change it. Ball one.
Try to get this runner at third base. Murray way in. If he butts it to Murray, Murray's got a play on.
They did have a play on.
But you got to throw
two
strikes.
Two balls, no strikes. You just have to throw strikes.
I don't think you'll see La Russa gambling here with anything but a bunt.
Third base coach Jim Leland handing the signs along. He was a fellow who was given some consideration for the crosstown job of the Chicago Cubs. Went to a former Baltimore coach and a resident of Baltimore, Jim Fry. 2-0 pitch to Dobzinski. And Comiskey Park now gets into the ballgame. This is the best opportunity the White Sox have had this afternoon. Tippy's not in any hurry. He's not going anywhere. And here comes that hometown crowd, as they should. Tippy is ready. Whoa, he almost threw it away. Dower saved his bacon. What a play from Dower. Tippy made a very bad throw at second base.
Not only saved his bacon, might have saved his game.
The count, two balls, no strikes to Dobzinski. Squire second, Vance Law at first. Obvious bunting situation, and the Orioles have had a game on. With Ripken going to third, there they go again. Well, this time it looked as though he was not bunting. He took it all away, and it's ball three, and Tippy is throwing himself into a mess. He almost threw the ball away at second base. And in an effort to get the ball where he wants it, down low where... He's just gotten behind now, three balls and no strikes to Dobzinski. And this enhances his opportunity to bunt somewhat more.
I think he'll be taking this pitch.
Yeah, he is. Strike, 3-1. he might take another, huh?
I think that in this situation, this is a good pitch to bunt right here, 3-1. I don't see him taking another one simply because he knows that Tippy's going to be trying to throw it right down the middle, and what he's going to be trying to do is make Todd Cruz feel it. Cruz up on the infield grass.
And the 3-1 pitch. The bunt is on. He bunts. Tippy Dempsey, third
ball.
Base.
We got him just what we needed.
They got him
just
at third.
Just what we needed. Was not a good bunt. Bounced it right up in front of Dempsey, who took the ball, made a good, accurate throw to third base, make sure of one, which he did. First and second, one away. Cruz the hitter.
He's walked and had a base hit in two trips, and he's stolen two bases.
You see Murray charging there. Dempsey coming out.
Cruz did that as a left-handed batter. Now he is a right-handed swinger against Tippy Martinez.
Hitter right-handed than he is left-handed.
Dempsey with a good save, ball one. Not a good bunt from Dibzinski. Dempsey hardly had to leave the plate area to make the grab, and perfect strike to Cruz.
That'd be a lie for anything with Cruz hitting, but I think that the number one priority is to drive someone in.
Ball two. That's Bill Veeck, who is covering this game for the Chicago Tribune and is a former owner of the Chicago White Sox franchise. He also figured prominently in the other ball club on the field, the St. Louis Browns, who became the Baltimore Orioles, were the property of Bill Veeck. His own Cleveland Indians. Two balls, a strike. Not as sharp as he'd like to be, but still even a little bit off form. Tippy's a whale of a potent factor to come in out of the bullpen. Now the 3-1 pitch.
Well, Cruz is going to get a fastball to hit here. Going to get a swing at it. 3-1. Got to come to him.
Keep charging.
Got a
play.
Shot at
now they stop holding. Him.
They got
now they got a runner
now.
Between second and
yes,
third.
Sir.
Now the runner coming to the plate.
Got him. Out.
Dempsey takes it and puts the tag on Law at the plate.
I tell you, I don't know what these guys are thinking about here in Chicago, but they have just kept us in the ball game as much as the last two nights. 3-1, Tippy had to come to him. Cruz was equal to the task. Line drive left field. Renicki playing short on Cruz. That's the reason they held him up. And here you see Dubzinski with his head down, running around second base. Gets hung up. We do the right thing. Cruz cuts it off, runs to Zimski's back. Soon as he gets him back towards second base, then the runner at third takes off. He almost could have tagged him, but you're not worried about him. You're worried about the runner going home, and Law cannot upend Dow. Dempsey at home. Outstanding throw by Dower.
7-5-4-2 and two out. Runners at first and second base.
And Rudy LaRussa can't believe it either.
But here is Rudy Law, and he might prove to be the tough man in this inning. Strike as Tippy got the curveball over. Law has not had a base hit this afternoon. He's had at least two in every other game. Boy, another hook. And you don't see Rudy get a bad swing like that very often. That ball must have really exploded. Two strikes.
I think you might say you'll have to look for it again.
No kidding. Two strike pitch. 1-2 now.
Been a very good player this series. Hit the ball on the nose just about every time up.
No, 2-2. Dempsey trying like everything to buy a strike. Well, got ahead of him, two strikes, and then it kind of nibbled somewhat. See if he'd chase a bad pitch. He didn't do it. Let's see what they do with the 2-2. Whoops, Eddie Murray fell down.
That's a balk. That's a balk.
Eddie Murray fell down as he broke to the bag and, well, didn't quite fall, but lost his footing. And Tippy Martinez commits the balk.
Even though you throw to first base, that first baseman has to be on the bag. If you throw it anyplace else, it's a balk. Now it's second and third, two away. 2-2 on a hitter.
And Altobelli is going to go out and talk to Tippy Martinez. Not as good as you can play.
Nope, you're right, Chuck. We've seen a lot of things this particular four-game series.
Well, the Orioles have had Scott McGregor balk in this playoff series, and now Tippy Martinez. And Altobelli just goes out. Hey, let's bear down on that guy with a bat in his hand. We got two out on the inning. Runners now at second and third. And Rudy Law. Eddie was breaking in for a pickoff at first base, and he stopped. And when he did, he slipped and almost sat down. And Tippy then made the throw to Eddie and should not have.
Now this makes it just a little bit tense because...
Here you go. Killing Renicky. Renicky coming. Renicky there.
Played him just right.
Oh, I'll tell you what. They really played him just right. And maybe old man Moe will swing around to the other dugout at the end of 7 in Game 4, Baltimore nothing Chicago. If it should turn out that this would be an Oriole victory today, Chicago fans are going to wonder for a long time how their White Sox came up with 3 base hits in the bottom of the 7th inning and didn't score. Base running.
Well, here it is, 3-1. Tippy's got to come to him, and Julio gets a bat out. Line drive, Renicky playing short and left field. You'll see the runner there around third. He holds him up now. It's a good throw by Renicky. Hits a cutoff man. And you'll see Dubzinski there.
See him?
Where is he going? My goodness gracious. We've got him in a rundown, but you're worried about the runner on third. Dower sees him going home. Fires a strike, and Dempsey there to put the tag on Vance Law. Thank you. This is the balk.
This is the balk throw. As Brooks said, that first baseman's got to be in the bag. If he's not, it's a balk.
Second and third, but the Orioles were winging along. They came out of it, and we go to the top half of the 8th inning. 0-0. Britt Burns on the mound for the White Sox.
And a ball one to the Oriole leadoff batsman, John Shelby. Tell you, here's a chance to compliment a couple of guys who just really don't get a lot of ink or a lot of praise, but they're in the dugout and in charge of positioning people defensively, and I'm talking about Jimmy Williams and Cal Ripken. And Gary Renicky was played in exactly the right spot.
Well, you know, you're right about that too, Chuck, the fact that Renicky was that's the first ball in the whole series that I've seen Law hit over there. Everything right. Else has been towards the second base side.
Now here is Tito Landrum. Britt Burns shutting the Orioles out on 4 hits. And the White Sox had 3 hits in the bottom of the 7th and couldn't score a run. And Landrum had a pretty good cut. Burns seems to be throwing just as hard here in the 8th as he was in the early going. Strong wind blowing from Brooks.
I was going to say, he had just a superb September this year, recording 2 runs a game. That's what he gave up in 6 starts. Had 2 shutouts. One of them was a one-hitter against the Angels.
Mm-hmm.
just hasn't got a lot of ink this year. He was 10 and 11, but the big thing is when you got three guys like Dotson and Bannister and Hoyt pitching, the way they were pitching, well, the four starter is a guy who you're not going to hear much about. But
well, I'll tell you, he's given the White Sox everything they could have hoped for this afternoon.
He is capable.
2-1 pitch. Out of play. Well, the attendance this afternoon is 45,477. Now the 2-2 offering to the Oriole right fielder, Tito Landrum. In for the injured Dan Ford. Just the pitcher's pitch. And strikeout number 7 is in the book for Chicago's Britt Burns.
Well, when he throws his curveball today, what he's trying to do is start it outside, bring it in on the outside part of the plate. He's done that very successfully.
Now Cal Ripken, who has hit into a double play, struck out and walked, and was wiped out when Renicki hit into a double play. Two out on the top of the eighth, no score, game 4. This has turned into a classic pitcher's battle. What a struggle. What a defensive battle. The White Sox ran themselves out of what could have been a heck of an inning in the bottom of the 7th. Strike pitch to Cal Ripken is due. What a difference when you're ahead of the hitter 0-2. One and two. Play. Two balls, two strikes to Ripken with two out, nobody on in this 8th inning.
If we do have game 5, is that 8:20 starting time tomorrow
night? You'll be able to get in a lot of running tomorrow, Brooks, if we have to stay.
Might be my first Sunday night game I've ever played, or ever announced.
No, we've done a few in Arlington, Texas.
That's right, 6 o'clock. 5:30.
Now the payoff 3-2 pitch on the way to Ripken. Out of play. Tell you what, the White Sox on the ropes here at Comiskey Park this afternoon. Backed into a corner, down 2-1. Called upon Britt Burns as their stopper, and he has been magnificent. Pitch this kind of a game any time in the year, it's outstanding. But to pitch this kind of a game under these conditions is just a tremendous effort. 3-2 pitch on the way to Ripken. Ball 4. That's the 5th walk.
2 strikes, no balls, and Cal Jr. works him for a walk to open up this 8th inning. 3rd hitter in this inning, I mean.
Tell you, I begin to look every now and then out to the Chicago bullpen, and there hasn't been any activity out there, really no need for any activity out there. I guess it's just wishful thinking on my part. If you could get this Mr. Burns out of there, your chances might be enhanced somewhat. What a great effort in a pressure ball game, Brooks. Good breaking ball.
I haven't seen one of those today. Slow overhand curve. Strike one.
One ball, one strike. The Orioles have yet to get a man beyond second base. 120 pitches by the Chicago left-hander Britt Burns. And here's his 1-1 pitch to Eddie Murray. Popped him up. Fisk is headed for the screen. Is the wind going to blow it out of play? Yes, it is. Almost into the upper deck. 1-2. Ripken at first base. The Orioles against Britt Burns this afternoon have just not come close to a threat. Base hit.
Left field. Ripken round at second
and
base.
He'll hold right there.
That's Murray's second base hit for today.
And headed to the plate now comes Gary Renicky.
Rhino walked the first two times up and grounded into a double play. Now we got some action. Barojas.
Salome Barojas in the White Sox pen. Gary Renicky. Burns has walked him twice and then got him to hit into a double play in the sixth inning. Almost got him. He just come inside. He's consistently come inside of the Oriole hitters today, and it has paid off. Now
don't think you'll see him throw him a fastball. You're gonna see a breaking ball of some sorts. If he does throw the fastball, it's gonna be inside, but I think it's gonna be a breaking ball.
Breaking ball.
About as hard as you can throw it, wasn't it?
It wasn't. You better believe it was thrown hard, Brooks.
He made up his mind that he was going to throw the fastball, but he was going to rear back and get a little extra, everything he had.
And you'll notice that it was on the inner portion of the plate. Due batter behind Renicky, it is designated hitter Al Bumbry.
3-0, do you let him swing? Why not? Get it out front.
He's hitting. Well, he's been coming inside all day, and it. Renicky on his way to first base, hit by the pitch to load the bases, and now the designated hitter is going to be Dan Ford.
Ford hitting for Bumbry. Here you see the pitch. Glancing blow off the backside. Bases loaded, two away. Dan Ford on his way to take his swings in place of Al Bumbry.
And out of the dugout on the third base side now comes manager Tony La Russa to have a word or two to say to Britt Burns. The Orioles finally get a man to third base with two out in the eighth inning. The bases are loaded. Dan Ford has been announced as the batter for Al Bumbry and thereby becomes the designated hitter. And folks, you have to believe me when I tell you this, but Dan Ford came to the ballpark today on crutches. Now he can move around, as you obviously as you can see, but the point of the crutches is to keep the weight off that injured foot, and they ask him to do that for a couple of days.
Well, I tell you, this is La Russa's made the decision to stick with Britt Burns.
Well, I'll tell you, who you got better than Burns, huh? He's really done a job for the White Sox today. Dan Ford in the playoffs, he's been in one ball game hitting 250, and that one hit was a double. Tell you, it is kind of a strange feeling though to get on the bus with the team and see Dan Ford get on board with crutches. But that's the only way, you know, you can move around and keep the weight off the foot, which is what he's been doing.
Well, you say, who else do you have besides Britt Burns, Chuck? And go ahead.
No,
I was going to say, you know, Barujas has been their short man all year. And if you want to go with the percentages, a right-hander against a right-hander.
Well, here we are.
I think what it comes down to is the fact that you've got Lowenstein sitting over there as the clanker. So you want to keep him out of the ball game.
That's exactly right. Here's Ford. Out of play.
Bring in Barujas, and then you got Lowenstein hitting against Barujas. So they just as soon have Burns hitting against Ford.
Tell you what I was thinking about one more mention of the crutches. Dan Ford had him in the aisle right alongside of his seat on the bus, and I wish you could have seen the security man when he got on the bus and he looked, saw those crutches. He was not too sure he was with a ball club. One strike pitch to Dan. Ford is discussing it with the plate umpire Evans, not heatedly, you know. But Dan's in the hole now with a count 0-2. Here's the pitch. Have to say it was a heck of a pitch on the part of Britt Burns. At least Jim Evans thought so. Ripken third, Murray second, Renicki first. Two out, two strike pitch to Ford. Pops him up. Wind blown, watching the second baseman. Cruz. That's it. At the end of 7 1/2, it continues. Baltimore, nothing. Chicago, nothing. News Scope is the next step in television news reporting, helping you understand how the day's events affect you. News Scope brings information to life weekday afternoons at 5 on Channel 2. Fisk, Baines, Lozinski are the new batters. To Tippi Martinez. Fisk had the infield hit in the first inning, popped to the second baseman, grounded to the third baseman. The attendance this afternoon at Comiskey is 45,477. Somewhat shy of the 46,635 in attendance last night. Here's Fisk. Tippy treated into the curveball. Now the 1-1 offering. Shelby in center field. This one hit well.
What a play, John Shelby.
Oh, my goodness, he got there. I'll tell you, here's a young man with speed enough to compensate for mistakes. That ball just cut a hole in the wind, Shelby overran it.
It sure did, Chuck. This has been a contrast, all these ball games. We've seen him play so bad and then play so great, but the Orioles have made some great plays today. Just an outstanding play from John Shelby.
Now the batter will be Harold Baines. He broke an 0-for streak. 0-for 14 in the playoffs with a sharply hit ground ball single to center field in the sixth inning.
Well, I mentioned talked about playing bad. I meant things that balk or running the bases or
missing pickoff signs.
Yeah, last 2 days, though, the Orioles have made some plays that you have to be proud of.
Well, if you remember in the Lamar Hoyt game, and you do, in the late innings of that ball game, the White Sox kept the pressure on the Orioles, and in the last three innings, the Orioles, defensively and with pitching and heads-up baseball, stranded six of the White Sox, refused to give in. They won 2-1, but they had a chance to break the ball game open three times in the late innings, and the Orioles stopped them. And that seemed to kind of get the ball club back in the groove.
Well, in this game, Renicki made a great catch in left field.
Didn't he, though?
Shelby. Dower made a couple of outstanding plays. Murray yesterday.
3-2 now to Harold Baines. Walk. Puts Baines aboard for Luzinski.
You have to respect it. Luzinski, the power of the Raging Bull, but he has been our All-American out today. Hitting off a left-hander might be a little different story.
Uh-huh.
Right-handers have been able to keep the ball in, keep it hard, and have had no problems.
Here's Eddie Murray, but it probably is going to be out of play. And it is.
Luzinski, two hits in this series. The first time up the first game, he lofted a ball down the right field line for a base hit. I don't remember what the other one was. He started, went into today's game with two base hits. Two for 10, two for 13 on the series.
Nice high strike. Two strikes to the bull. Chief hitting bull is where they sometimes refer to Greg Luzinski. Baines at first with one away. Last half of the eighth that you just joined us. No score. Look out.
Oh my goodness.
Boy, that's terrible. I hope everybody's all right down there. That's the area in which the barrel end of the bat came down, and I hope everybody's okay.
They're shaking their head, yes.
Yep, okay, that's great. You know, a lot of times, even though you see it coming, you're packed in among people and you can't make the kind of a move that you would normally make to defend yourself and protect yourself. Well, a new piece of lumber, and Martinez ready to work again to Luzinski with a count two strikes.
Cruz deep at third. Ripken looking for the double play ball.
He's gone. Called third strike. Two down on the inning, of the batter now, Tom Pachorik. What a battle. What an all-out battle between the White Sox and the Orioles in this fourth game. You'd never think it could be that hard to score one single run by either club. You know, just nobody. The White Sox will be asking themselves, or their fans will be asking themselves, quite a while, whatever happened in that seventh inning when they got three base hits and couldn't come up with a run. Tippy behind to Pashorek. Two balls, no strikes. Three balls, no strikes. Well, it's always been tough for the Orioles. I don't care what suit he's wearing, whether it was Seattle or whether it's Chicago. He's a tough man to handle.
Mike Squire is on deck. This would be an interesting pitch. You go with your best control pitch. With his second best control pitch, which might be his first. I don't know the way he throws his fastball and curve.
He throws both of them well, doesn't he, Brooks?
I tell you, that was great pitch right there. 3-1, breaking ball for a strike.
Three balls, two strikes. Baines will be going. There he goes. See if Ripken gets there. He's there now. His throw to first base. And here we go again at the end of eight at Comiskey. Orioles nothing, and the White Sox nothing. Britt Burns is still out there on the mound firing for the White Sox. And before he takes on the Orioles in the ninth inning, we're going to pause 5 seconds for station identification on this, the Orioles 83 Baseball Network.
Thorner, Benton, Saunders, Phillips. Watch the team work on Channel 2.
Well, we're in the trivia inning. And this afternoon's trivia question brought to you, of course, by the Provident Bank of Maryland. Who holds the American League record for the highest batting average in a three-game championship series? Who holds the American League record for the highest batting average in a three-game championship series?
Did it happen in,
I don't know.
69, 70, 71?
I'm not going to tell you.
Oh, okay. I'm just trying to figure out when the series went three games. I know they did the first 3 years, 69, 70, and 71, but too many years have passed.
Well, let's watch Dower here in the ninth. No runs, five hits, the Orioles. No runs, seven hits, the White Sox. The Orioles have stranded nine men, and the White Sox eight. Now the 1-1 pitch to Dower. Three balls, a strike. Remember, Britt Burns is well over 120 pitches at the moment. And they figure the norm somewhere, what, around 115, I guess. Another pop-up, the wind driving it around. Julio Cruz says, I got it, I got it, I got it. And here comes Rudy Law. Two-out surge on the part of the White Sox in the bottom of the ninth. Got Squires and a comebacker to the mound. Law and a fly ball to center field. Then Dubczynski. Dubczynski hit one over the head of Ripken for a base hit. And Julio Cruz went the other way with a line drive single to right field.
There goes Cruz. We let him go.
And it's out of play.
Ball fouled
that
off.
Of course, helped somewhat. Strike one. And on the foul ball back to first base comes Julio Cruz.
Dower somewhat shortened up just in case Law wants to try to bunt. Murray back of Cruz, giving him all he wants to take. He'll be off and running again. The only thing with running in this situation, it could distract the hitter some. There he goes.
And a ball. One and one. Well, that eliminates the force. One of those nifty curveballs from Tippy Martinez. If he's got one more like that left, he'll trot it out right now.
This has been a different kind of game, believe me.
Well, after regulation nine, the Orioles, no runs, five hits. Chicago, no runs, nine hits. The Orioles have stranded nine men. The White Sox have stranded 10. Extra inning games, the White Sox have been dynamite in overtime battles. They have been in 11, and they have won 8. The Orioles have been in 16 extra inning games and have won 9. And here we go.
White Sox have got Barojas up and throwing. So maybe they know something we don't. Maybe they know they're going to have to change pitchers this inning.
I just can't say enough about Britt Burns in this kind of a situation where, you know, this is a game that you have to win. There isn't any tomorrow. And this man has just refused to buckle. He has come after the Orioles very aggressively and pitched a super ball game. And now John Shelby.
Would you believe one run this inning?
I wonder if one run would be enough.
Yeah.
And the sun begins to shine rather brightly. We have scattered clouds around the ballpark at the moment. And here is a 1-0 pitch to John Shelby. Shelby had an infield hit back in the first inning. Since that time, against Britt Burns, called out on strikes, fouled out to the catcher, grounded to the shortstop, and here he is in the 10th inning.
Talking about left on base, Chuck, that runs Chicago's total to 35 in 4 games.
Wow.
That they've left on base.
Balls, two strikes. Cal Ripken this afternoon against Burns is 0 for 2 plus 2 walks. Eddie Murray is 2 for 4 out of play. Landrum, and who's in the on-deck circle and will follow Shelby, also has one hit this afternoon against Burns, but it was a scratch hit, an infield hit. Has fanned 7 so far. Gone, number 8. Now Tito Landrum.
Here it is. Strike 3 to Shelby.
Whereas most of the pitchers today kind of do a pretty good job of staying away from the hitter. Here's a man who has spent the greater part of the afternoon working inside to the Oriole hitters, Britt Burns. Ball one to Tito. So you think it's easy to win a championship, huh? Wait a minute.
Oh, my goodness.
Hold on to this one.
I believe
get
one.
Get out
run
of here. Ball.
The deck.
Home run, Tito Landrum.
Oh, and he didn't. Did he miss it?
It just cut a hole in the wind, and Landrum has scored the first run in the ball game here in the 10th inning. And you think that dugout won't greet him? Watch this.
Yes, sir. Give him a high five, Eddie Murray. Boy, howdy. He's lived inside all day, but that time he didn't quite get it in there. And Tony La Russa on his way to make the change.
And the White Sox left-hander Burns, who has just given the White Sox everything he had to give, and it was awfully good, has made one mistake here in the 10th inning. And Tito Landrum, not the kind of a guy you count on for power by any stretch of the imagination, takes him deep. The White Sox fans reward Britt Burns with a great ovation, and he justly deserves it for the effort he has made this afternoon. And while the new pitcher makes his way to the mound, let us pause for these words. Here's the home run swing of Tito Landrum. I said, not the kind of a fellow that you think of as a power hitter, and then I said, wait a minute. And I looked at what he did in Louisville this year. In 111 games, Brooks, he had 23 doubles, 12 triples, and 18 home runs.
Mm-hmm. Got some power.
So I make the correction.
Went in the upper deck on a line.
From the bullpen now comes Salome Barojas. And this will be his second appearance.
Barojas, pitcher who likes to pitch just out of the strike zone, likes to swing at a few borderline pitches, keeps the ball down.
Barojas worked an inning in game two Thursday night in Baltimore. And the pitch to Rip. Ball one. I don't know whether or not we were able to get the picture because there were other things that had to be done at the moment. Strike to Ripken, but there was something that happened in the Oriole dugout when Britt Burns left that I think bears talking about. The Orioles applauded Britt Burns as he walked off the mound. Rick Dempsey looked his way and tipped the cap for a truly gutty performance. Look out, Salome, and there's an Oriole base hit. And here comes Eddie Murray. Isn't it kind of typical, Brooks, as you look back over the Orioles year, how many of the so-called lesser lights, if that might not be the proper phrase, but not the regular fellas, the guys who were in there day after day, have jumped into the middle of things and delivered and helped the Orioles win ball games or put them in a position to win.
Well, that's certainly the team concept. When you look at some other ball clubs, you see a lot of individuals who I think have more talent, teams that might have more talent, but they don't play together as well as the Orioles do. And it's a 25-man squad, and I think that over the years that Earl Weaver and Al Tibelli has managed this year, when they bring 25 guys back from spring training, they use 25 guys.
There you go. Well, they've got a 1-0 lead in the 10th inning of game four. And if you're thinking about what the White Sox can muster in the 10th inning, Fisk, Baines, Lozinski,
base hit. Ripken's going to try it.
No,
he's
going to
hold.
No,
I don't blame
not.
You. I think I'd hold, too.
Harold's got a shotgun out there. And Gary Renicky. One out in the inning. The inning started innocently enough with a called third strike to John Shelby. And then Tito Landrum got a 1-0 pitch and hit it out of here like a rocket. And the wind is still blowing straight in from left field, but that ball was kind of a line drive. The wind didn't have a thing to do with it. La Russa has gone to the mound.
Yeah, there's Jeff Lamp.
Dennis Lamp,
I'm sorry. And Agosto.
Haven't seen him yet. Was the pregame ceremony, and you're seeing Ron Kittle helped back into the dugout, and you can understand his explosive response now a little bit more, because that had to be extremely painful. But to his everlasting credit, Kittle said, "Hey, I just lost my cool." He said there was no need for that, and it takes a man to admit that. Here now is Renicky. He's walked twice, but hit by a pitch and hit into a double play. Ball one. Guess who's in the on-deck circle?
John Lowenstein.
Let it be Lowenstein.
You can bet that he'll have to hit off of a left-hander and not a right-hander.
Yeah, Augusto's out there. This may be a base hit.
Yes, sir.
Headed home comes Ripken. And the Orioles now lead 2-0. And Barojas is having a tough afternoon in relief.
Renicky hits this ball right off the end of the bat. A squibber, semi-line drive down the right field line. And you can see everything you want to see right there on Tony La Russa's face.
Lowenstein is now announced into the game as a designated hitter.
And here comes Tony La Russa to make the move.
The minute he's announced in, La Russa is going to go to the bullpen and get himself another pitcher. And while the new pitcher makes his way to the mound, let us pause for these words. Juan Augusto, the southpaw, is out of the Chicago bullpen as pitcher number 3 here in game number 4. Lowenstein, now it's Derek. He's not the designated hitter, and you're right. Benny Ayala is the designated hitter. Ayala will bat now for John Lowenstein, and this is his first appearance in the playoff series. And this has been kind of an off year for Benny, and one of the reasons, I believe, is that as it developed, he just did not get to see as many left-handers. He only got in 47 ball games, had 104 at-bats, and hit .221. But yet he had 7 doubles and 4 home runs and 13 runs batted in, and you know how happy he feels to be a part and get into one of these playoff games, a championship game. Nothing Baltimore. And here is Benny Ayala against Juan Augusto. Murray at third, Renicky at first. And a ball one to Benny.
Augusto started the 83 season with the Denver Bears.
started his professional career with the Red Sox organization. Fastball.
Oh, what a move from Augusto. Boy, that was really a nifty move. Renicky's saying, am I still in the game? All ready to go. 1-0 pitch. The Heat's hit it a ton to center field.
He sure did. Rudy Law.
Look out, Rudy. He made the catch. Another run home and down to second after the catch goes Renicky. Benny, my goodness, what a shot into that wind. Three to nothing, the Orioles. And some of the hardy White Sox fans now begin to make their way to the exits. Rich Dower is the batter, and Tony La Russa is going to go to the bullpen for a right-hander.
Dennis Lamp.
These two runs are the responsibility of the departed Barojas, and we're going to get another pitcher, and while the new pitcher makes his way to the mound, let us pause for these words. The wind continues to roar in from center field and left field at Comiskey Park in Chicago. However, the sky looks a little bluer than it has at any time today. And the Orioles just shut down, completely stopped by Britt Burns through the first nine innings. He got one out on the 10th inning, and then Tito Landrum, who was in the game in right field because Dan Ford is unable to run, hit a home run to break up a mess of goose eggs on the board, and that was the springboard. From there, the Orioles have gone on to three runs in this 10th inning, and Dennis Lamb has been summoned to face Rich Dower.
Lamp along the same lines as Barojas. Likes to pitch a little out of the strike zone, everything down. Fastballs in, sliders away.
Well, Dower this afternoon has fly to left, grounded the third, hit, bunted, sacrificed perfectly back in the seventh inning and popped to the second baseman. And he's got Gary Renicky at second base and would love nothing better than to drive in run number four. Two out in the inning.
Two away, two strikes on Dower. Renicky at second base. Three runs, nine hits for the Orioles. No runs, nine hits for the Sox. Still in the top of the 10th inning. Cal Ripken Sr.
Not nearly as cold as it has been, huh, Brooks? All of a sudden it got nice and warm, and it's a balmy sort of a breeze. And a two-strike pitch to Dower. Mm-mm. A ball and two strikes. Remember, there's a lot of work yet to be done. Fisk, Baines, Luzinski in the Chicago 10th inning. Well, shortstop and Dibzinski's throw takes care of Dower, and that's it. But now at the end of 9 1/2 in game four, it's the Orioles 3 and the White Sox nothing. Well, here comes the bottom of the 10th inning from Chicago. Carlin Fisk, Harold Baines, Greg Luzinski are the due batters. Fisk this afternoon as 1-for-4, and in his only plate appearance against Tippy Martinez, fly to the center fielder, John Shelby. And here is Tito Landrum, the guy who lit the fuse with a line drive home run to give the Orioles a 1-0 lead in the 10th inning. White Sox fans are trying their best to see if they can spark a comeback by the Western Division champions. Martinez felt uncomfortable coming across the rubber and just stopped. Ball one. And a strike now to Carlton.
Carlton looking for his first base hit today. Line deep to right center field.
He got a base hit? Yeah, he had one in the first inning, remember?
All right.
Right by pitcher Storm Davis, and Dower made the dive behind the bag, and he couldn't get anything on it. That was...
Well, the last time up, he hit a tremendous drive to center field as Shelby made a fine running catch.
2-1. Stoddard is up in the bullpen and I believe is ready.
Hit
to left field. Renicki seems to have it in range, and Renicki is there for the first out. Now, when you get the ball out in that area toward left center field, the wind is going to have an effect on it. But the ball that Landrum hit, Tito's shot, was, you know, just yanked right down the left field side. Didn't get very high. He just crushed it. Harold Baines. There's a pretty good picture of Orioles starters who have brought the Orioles where they are right now. Strike to Harold Baines, champions of the Eastern Division, and two outs away from the championship of the American League. Now the count is two strikes to Baines. Think of all of the people who have worked so hard to get this club where they are right now. And a victory here would be the culmination of a super year that has certainly been filled with pitfalls, ups and downs, seven-game losing streaks, people on the disabled list. There were some really tough moments for the Orioles, and they never lost their poise, just continued to do their job. And if they can get two outs here in this 10th inning, they can lay claim to the championship of the American League. Well, Tippy felt a little strong in that pitch, and he tried to bust it low and outside and missed. And the class of the Western Division of the American League, right on your screen there a moment ago. Base hit for Harold Baines. Well, he was 0 for 14 in this series, and this afternoon he's 2 for 3. Make it 2 for 4. And the batter is Luzinski, and there is still work to be done. That's Stoddard out in the pen. Now, in his only plate appearance this afternoon against Tippy, Luzinski looked at a third strike in the eighth inning. Strike one.
Cruz, and there's Harold Baines, your runner. All the hitters are going to be taking one, but evidently Luzinski's looking for that fastball, the second pitch too.
That's it. Second out in the 10th inning, and now the Orioles are one out away from the championship. Three strikeouts for Tippy Martinez, and here is one of the tough outs that the Orioles have had to battle all year, Tom Pachorek. He has one hit in four trips this afternoon. You're beginning to get that feeling? I'll tell you, it's a great feeling to have. And there's the man of the hour, Tito Landrum.
I'm just taking a look at Edward Bennett Williams and Hank Peters and his wife.
Where are they? Oh.
They're right by the dugout. And,
oh, yes, I see them now.
I swear, you'd think you're 10 runs behind.
Well, I didn't sleep too well last night. I was awake at 5:30 this morning, 6:30 down in the lobby. Went out to get a paper in the rain, and who do I walk into but Edward Bennett Williams doing the same thing. We looked at each other, didn't know what to say. Went back into the hotel and started a talk. Now the 1-1. A ball and two strikes to Pechorek. And guess who came down 5 minutes later? Jimmy Williams. They were all rolling out early today. Just, you know, you get keyed up. All your thoughts are about it. And Tippy Martinez in the spotlight and has done it so many times this year. For the Orioles, and it's only fitting that in the final game, what apparently is going to be the final game of the championship series, that he should be the man of the moment. He struck him out. If Dempsey makes the throw perfectly, he does. It's over.
There they are.
They've done it. They have done it.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Well, they
well
buried Tippy. And the Orioles are the best in the American League and now await whatever the National League can offer them and will. The Sox fans are on their feet, applauding their team as they go to the dugout. The Orioles just, they've been a 25-man team. They have been a solid unit. The thing that has impressed me about this club as much as anything is the fact that going good, going bad, they have never lost their poise. They are a very solid group of outstanding young professionals. And happiness is what you see on your screen right now. Tito Landrum is the figure. He's the guy in the middle. He's the man who swung the home run bat that started it all. And the Orioles, yes, they're mighty happy, and there's a lot of hugging and many smiles, but it's still kind of a calm, under control, sort of a celebration. And Al Bumbry just delighted, and there's always the other side of the coin. And you saw the tear-filled countenance of a Chicago White Sox fan. Nothing to be sorry for. The White Sox obviously were the best team in the Western Division. And fitting this year that the two best teams in the American League battled it out. And what a battle it was. And the Orioles win it in 10 innings. Well, your nearby Dotson dealers are going to donate $100 per Oriole broadcast to the favorite charity, the Dotson Player of the Game. And the Dotson Player of the Game today is Tito Landrum. And in Tito Landrum's name, a $100 donation will go to the Johns Hopkins Children's Clinic. And the winner of this afternoon's Big Mac attack is Betty Meister of Meadow Road from the Ritchie Highway McDonald's. And she wins $300. Congratulations to Betty Meister. WMAR and McDonald's want to thank the many thousands of loyal fans who have helped make the Big Mac attack one of the most exciting and rewarding promotions this season. And we'll be back with more right after this message. The Orioles get back to Baltimore's airport to BWI tonight. You better believe there isn't. Let me read you some of the stuff if you intend to be there and take part. There will be a rally tonight at Baltimore Washington International Airport. The rally will take place at the Northeast property. Now, that's the freight area of the airport. Signs will be posted at the airport entrance, and fans are requested not to go to the regular passenger terminal, as the Orioles charter flight from Chicago will be arriving in the area of the rally. The Orioles are expected to arrive in Baltimore between 8:30 and 9:30 p.m. tonight. The rally is going to begin at about 8:15. Now, do not go to the terminal. Go to the freight area, and there'll be signs, okay? What are we going to celebrate? Championship. Brooks, it's a great feeling.
And Chuck.
What a way to finish the year. And
let's see you next year.
I hope so. I certainly do. And here's the way it all started. Struggling against Britt Burns into the 10th inning, and Tito Landrum swings the bat, and this is what broke what seemed to be a never-ending string of goose eggs on the scoreboard, and the Orioles suddenly were ahead by a score of 1-0.
A valiant effort from Britt Burns, and that was his last pitch of the ball game. And Barojas came on, faced three men. He couldn't get anybody out. That seemed to be just the jolt that the Orioles needed, and they went on to a three-run 10th inning and go on to a championship of the American League. And now, is it going to be I-95 series, Brooks?
I think that would be fantastic. I know most of the people are pulling for a Phillies-Oreo World Series. We were supposed to have that back in 1964, and the Phillies didn't make it. The Orioles didn't make it. So maybe this will be the year, but it was a great game. It was a game of missed opportunities almost. Both pitchers pitched excellent baseball several times. The Orioles had some men on and could not get them home. And as we mentioned before, Chuck, it was this whole four-game series was a study in contrast almost, because I have seen some things that I've never seen before. Plus, I mean, talk about bad plays, good plays, balks, it was just an interesting series, and the Orioles came out here with the job cut out for them. 1-1 came out here, went two in a row, and highly unexpected.
Well, I really think this is a kind of an honest evaluation of this championship series. The better team did win. The Orioles are just a better team over the long run, and fortunately for the Orioles, over the short run, they proved themselves the better team. And well, we've got a lot of celebrating and interviews coming up from the Victor's Clubhouse, so why don't we all go down and join in right now, okay?
And come back, and I just really, from the fourth, fifth inning on, I just had to gut it out, and I told them I was tired, but they said, well, just keep going one more inning, we'll see if we can get to the sixth, and maybe Tiffy will come in.
You know, you're 3 years out of high school. What's this moment like for you?
It's exciting. These are the greatest bunch of guys in the world. It's just exciting to go to the World Series at 21 years of age. I just got to thank the Lord for it.
As you're watching a game like this develop after you've left the game, what's going through your mind?
Well, it was just an up and down battle mentally. Whenever the White Sox would get two runners on there in the seventh, and I just knew they were going to score, and then again in the ninth, I was thinking about tomorrow. I was thinking about how we're going to hit Lamar. But I'm glad we don't have the chance.
This is a pressure situation for a young guy to come into. Did you have any trouble sleeping last night?
No, none at all. I just relaxed and said, well, you know, I'm just going to go out there and pitch my type of game. And I just did a lot of praying and just want to relax and go out there and just pitch.
Okay, Storm Davis, let's see quickly if we can find somebody else. Eddie Murray. Eddie, can you come over here a second? Now, people talked a lot about that 0-for-29 slump, and then you had the home run yesterday, 3-of-4 today. Were you getting pretty tired of those questions?
Well, yeah, a little bit, because I couldn't really change what happened at World Series or whatever. And, you know, for me, it was just like an 0-for-8, which I've been plenty of times. You go 0-for-2 ball games.
A lot of people felt this club has had the talent. In 79 against the Pirates, you lost within the division. In 81 against the Yankees, 82 against the Brewers. Is this the year for you guys?
I hope it is, really. We seem to have got everything going right now, and just hope we can continue to stay healthy. Well, that's mainly our problem. We having trouble, you know, sometimes building the right guys that we normally have out there.
Okay, Eddie Murray, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's send it back upstairs now to Bob Costa.
Thank you, Bill. Congratulations to the Orioles. They're going to the series, and Tony, it's been a great experience working with you this year. Thank you very much. I learned a lot.
All right, Bob. Well, if you want to look at it negatively, White Sox left 35 on base, but give the credit to McGregor, Boddicker, Flanagan, Davis, Sammy Stewart, and Tippi Martinez.
For Tony Kubek, I'm Bob Costas. Sports World is coming up in just a moment on NBC. It's the Orioles over the White Sox, 3-1. So long, everybody.
Well, I'd like to remind you, a new scene 2 coming up at 6 o'clock will have all of the highlights, all of the celebration, all of the fun that we're not able to take part in right now. We're up here, but we're just as happy as could be. We hope that you'll be at BWI tonight. Now, remember, don't go to the terminal. There'll be plenty of signs posted. The last rally when the Orioles clinched coming home from Milwaukee was really outstanding. Didn't have any trouble at all. People got in and out of the area. A great big crowd was there. Just follow the signs. Do not go to the terminal. And the flight is scheduled into Baltimore somewhere between 8:30, 9:30 tonight. The celebration party at the airport begins at about 8:15. And we'll be with you. We'll be back there in just a little while. Orioles 83. It's been brought to you by Budweiser, the proud sponsors of the United States Olympic team. For what you do, this Bud's for you. Nissan, makers of Datsun, and your nearby Datsun dealers. Ezrine Auto Centers, your local General Tire dealer. Sooner or later, you'll own Generals.
Coca-Cola. Coke is it. Blue Cross Blue Shield, it's the most important card you carry. And that's the story from Comiskey Park in Chicago. The Orioles are the champs of the American League and now head for the World Series. It begins in Memorial Stadium in Baltimore Tuesday night. I guess a lot of people are hopeful that it will be an I-95 World Series, and we hope that maybe that'll be it. For all of the people connected with Oriole Television this year, and particularly the gang back home at WMAR, the people who have done the job so beautifully for us all year long, Brooks and I want to express our heartfelt thank you, because without those kind of people, you just don't get the job done. They're a joy to work with, and they're an outstanding crew, and we thank them for their effort. We thank the people in Chicago for the wonderful job they have done for us out here. And Brooks, it's been a pleasure, and I hope we get a chance to do it again. And good luck to the Orioles in the upcoming World Series. That's it. See you again.